Well, Peter Schiff has predicted a global meltdown being triggered by China, just like Mr. Dent has. He'll be joining us in the second hour today, and we'll have open phones. There is so much news we're going to be getting into. Look at this headline of the Financial Times of London. Chinese launch floating fortress project directly out of 1984. And it ties into this article out of the Chicago Business News. The dirty truth of hospital cleaning, thin science. You say, what's it have to do with China and floating fortresses? Well, it turns out that infections in hospitals are killing more people than in America's biggest wars. And speaking of biggest wars, classified Pentagon exercise reveals U.S. would struggle to win war with Russia. It would, quote, take everything we had. Well, who are we? Our country's been hijacked by offshore globalists. And here's Paul Watson's report dealing with the color revolution the West is trying to launch in Russia right now.
While everyone was obsessing over Caitlyn Jenner, Cecil the Lion, and Donald Trump, the United States was accelerating its plan to provoke a color revolution in Russia that could lead to a toppling of Putin's government and a complete reordering of the international power structure. As I first highlighted last month, Russian Parliament member Yevgeny Fedorov went public to reveal a plot on behalf of the US State Department to contrive a staged Kiev-style revolution that would force Putin to step down and lead to the collapse of the Russian Federation within 2 years.
Они ведут переговорный процесс с российскими элитами о выдаче Путина. Так же, как они ведут такой же переговорный процесс по Януковичу.
Fedorov asserts that Russian oligarchs have been paid off to facilitate this coup, which will involve hundreds of thousands of people flooding the streets of Moscow to start a violent rebellion against Putin after a further collapse in the Russian economy causes food prices to soar.
После августа, я думаю, что через зиму, через падение жизненного уровня, им удастся к весне вытащить на улицы несколько сотен тысяч человек, как в Армении. И просто потому что
they'll use a drop in living standards to cause the revolution. Same thing here.
Чтобы устроить бунт,
then Soros leads
нужно там 1100-200 просто голодных людей, как в Армении, из которых там 90% может быть и в темную использовано, но при этом они организованы. То есть им как бы не говорят, что они на американцев, им просто говорят, вот вы голодные, голодные, выходите.
Fedorov's revelations were confirmed by the fact that Moscow is now banning organizations from Russia that were involved in the Ukrainian coup d'etat, including the National Endowment for Democracy and Freedom House. As F. William Engdahl notes, the NED, along with Freedom House, has been at the center of all US State Department-financed color revolutions in the world since 2000, when it was used to topple Milosevic in Serbia. This action was taken after Putin signed into law a measure which effectively criminalizes the activity of non-governmental organizations that threaten to undermine Russia's constitutional stability. China also recently passed a new law which restricts the activities of foreign NGOs. The two superpowers are finally waking up to the fact that regime change plots in the modern age are achieved not via bombs and tanks, but via mass subversion. Expect to see an intensification of the propaganda campaign against Russia over the next few months, starting with a blame game being laid at Moscow's door for the downing of Flight MH17. Some will be skeptical as to how a president with an approval rating in the high 80s could possibly be overthrown. But the very fact that NATO and the White House are even considering this illustrates their staggering disconnect with reality, which, blinded by neo-colonial imperatives, threatens to place the world in the most dangerous jeopardy since the height of the Cold War.
Exactly. And what's the Pentagon thinking? You can't win a war with nuclear weapons. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome, and thank you so much for joining us on this live Friday the 14th, 2015, worldwide transmission. Hard to believe that 2015 is already more than half gone and getting long in the tooth. I will be back this Sunday live in studio 4 to 6 p.m. Central Standard Time. And, of course, there's the InfoWars Nightly News tonight, as there is each weeknight, Monday through Friday, at 7 p.m. all times Central. Overwhelming headlines, overwhelming information. Hillary Clinton is being called the Democratic Party's ticking time bomb. She is a testament to the fact that she's a Democrat and she's a woman. And so she is allowed to get away with bloody murder. Not just taking money from foreign dictators at the State Department to sell them weapons. Not just being involved in Benghazi. Not just being involved in cattle futures and deaths and corruption and all the rest of it. Going after our guns, trying to ram through the first Obamacare scam. There's literally hundreds of bad things Hillary Clinton's done. Caught lying to Congress over and over again. Involved in Fast and Furious. Involved in IRS persecution gate. But now, after a year of refusing to turn over her emails or more, she wipes the servers, which is obstruction of justice on its face. There are subpoenas, there are search warrants, and sure, here it is, erased, just like the IRS did. So she's finally handed it over after it's been professionally wiped clean. But Obama, that means the Clintons, run the Justice Department, and so she is basically above the law. The majority of Americans support a criminal investigation of Hillary emails, national polls show. That's out of the Washington Times. Here's another one. Hillary Clinton, the Democratic Party's ticking time bomb. The countless crimes of Hillary Clinton, special prosecutor needed now. Oh, like Ken Starr, that'll do nothing. Go after him for sex, but not for missile secrets to the Chinese government. You know, now that we're on the verge of war with the communist Chinese, and the Russians, who they shared it with, not that the Russians needed our technology. We got a lot of it from them and the Germans. But the Chinese certainly needed it. They allowed Laurel and Hughes to transfer the MIRV technology and the liftoff and separation technology so that their Long March missiles in the mid-90s, every one of them was blowing up on the launch pad or a few thousand feet in the air. They couldn't get up into orbit. Well, after they got all of NASA, all the German and all the Russian research that the Russians had shared with the United States as well, all their missiles basically get off the ground now and get into orbit. And then they sit around saying, don't criticize the government, it undermines confidence, or we need to take all your rights away. ISIS is set to strike when the border's wide open. They're saying there is an imminent plot to try to assassinate the Queen of England in the next week. That video report is up on InfoWars.com. For the first time ever, they're going to randomly ask for everybody's IDs in London on the streets as if that's going to stop some type of jihad attack, like we've seen in Paris and other areas, when our own governments financed and run these organizations. And England has been more heavily involved, of all the countries involved, Turkey, France, you name it, arming ISIS, letting them recruit in the West, and now they'll use the threat to take people's rights in the UK. It is truly disgusting. We're going to get into that. Drudge, Fox News could be censored under new federal rules, expert warns. Well, yeah, they've said in Congress that's the plan. Justice Department joins private discrimination lawsuit against Arizona's Joe Arpaio because he dares arrest illegals when they commit crimes. They're also readying a lawsuit against the black Democrat sheriff of Travis County, they've announced, because he deports between 3 and 7 illegals a week who are aggravated felons, or he gives them to the feds to deport. And the Democratic Party says, you will release aggravated felons. This is in the newspaper with a straight face. They go, yeah, it's terrible. He's a Democrat. He's black. But it's pretty racist that he deports between 3, 5, 7. The numbers vary every week, less than 10. He should be deporting all of them. But no, he deports aggravated felons, so he's in the news every week, the devil. And the Travis County Sheriff's Department's a pretty good sheriff's department from everything I've seen, living here for 25 years. And so they've now got them on the national news, the local news, demonizing it to run the sheriff out, because you can't have one shred of sanity in America. You can't have one county or one city anywhere where there is sanity reigning. Oh, you're a rapist. Oh, you're an arsonist. Oh, you've assaulted and stabbed people. We're going to, you know, deport you. No, no, no. So we've got that. Jeb Bush won't rule out torture tactics, says they're effective. How about they're illegal? We're going to talk about that. Chinese launch floating fortress project. Oil price hits lowest level in 6.5 years. Fish oil helps minimize disorders for those at risk of schizophrenia, study finds. We already knew this, but now it's in Newsweek and Time today. And then this crazy headline that I'm going to John Bounds report here in a moment on the imminent assassination of the queen, they're saying. Total hype, total fear-mongering. The dirty truth of hospital cleaning, something that kills more Americans than anything else, that's coming up. Any other unnatural cause, I should say. Heart problems and then cancer is really the number one cause, then automobiles. Classified Pentagon exercise revealed U.S. would struggle to win war with Russia. It would take everything we had, is the headline. That's all coming up. But first, here's John Bounds' report on the situation in the UK with the British treasonous government using the ISIS group they've helped create to now take UK freedom. Here it is. Video at
High alert in Britain as the facade of terror attacks similar to the ones orchestrated in Boston supposedly threaten the lives of the royal court. Scotland Yard's Royal Protection Branch and the Home Office have been informed of the plot that includes the Queen and also reportedly includes Prince Charles and possibly the British Prime Minister David Cameron. The attack will supposedly occur at an event next weekend to commemorate the anniversary of the end of the Second World War. Locations allegedly targeted include the St. Martin's in the Field Church, the Field Marshal Slim statue, and Westminster Abbey. The unsubstantiated threat will result in increased security for the event. Veterans have been told they must provide photographic identification to obtain tickets, according to the Daily Mail, something they've never been asked of before. But is this just another mass psyop, another rollout by the global military-industrial complex to prepare the public for future orchestrated attacks? The colluding ties between British intelligence and Islamic extremist leaders reach back before 9/11. In 1996, British intelligence paid al-Qaeda around $160,000 to fund an assassination plot against Libyan leader Muammar al-Qaddafi. The British press was banned from discussing the case. The New York Times asked, did the British government try to assassinate Colonel Muammar al-Qaddafi, the Libyan leader, in February 1996 by planting a bomb under his motorcade, and did the plan go awry because agents from MI6, the Foreign Intelligence Service, put the bomb under the wrong car, killing several Libyan bystanders? Britons may never know the answer. A sweeping injunction has barred newspapers and television news programs from publishing the embarrassing allegations about the inner workings of Britain's security services, brought up by a disgruntled former officer. The media have been forced to discuss the allegations without actually saying what the allegations are. Abu Hamza al-Masri, the imam presiding over the infamous Finsbury Park Mosque. Hamza began working for British intelligence and police in 1997. He informed on fellow Muslims and was granted favors by MI5, including the release of suspected terrorists. Hamza told his aides he was beyond the reach of British law. In 1999, Hamza would be implicated in the kidnapping and murder of Western tourists in Yemen. He would tell police he was following the Quran and would be released. The police returned to Hamza audio tapes packed with usual messages of intolerance and hatred and culminating in exhortations to kill the enemies of Islam. Harun Rashid Aswad, a top aide to Abu Hamza, would later be singled out as the supposed mastermind of the London 7/7 bombings. Aswad is also suspected of working with British intelligence. Omar Bakri Mohammed, who collaborated with Osama bin Laden, also worked for British intelligence. The British government knows who we are, he said. MI5 has interrogated us many times. I think now we have something called public immunity. Bakri admitted in 2001. Like many jihadists, the Syrian-born Imam was connected to the Muslim Brotherhood, a documented British and later CIA intelligence asset. The terrorist who trained the London bombers was a U.S. informant. The London Guardian reports, citing his exceptional cooperation in working with the U.S. authorities, a New York judge released Mohammed Junaid Babar, despite him pleading guilty to 5 counts of terrorism. The 10th of December of last year, 6 years after his initial arrest and subsequent guilty plea, he was sentenced to time served and charged $500 by the court in a special assessment fee. Other leaders of Islamic extremism protected by the British government in what is now being dubbed Londonistan include al-Libi, implicated in the alleged al-Qaeda bombings of 2 U.S. embassies in Africa, Abu Qatada, the radical imam told MI5 agency exercised powerful spiritual influence over the Algerian community in London. The cleric's sermons were found in a flat in the German city of Hamburg, used by some of those involved in 9/11. In May, the British government fast-tracked a proposal to allow police to monitor the conversations of alleged terrorists. We will introduce legislation to combat groups and individuals who reject our values and promote messages of hate, said Home Secretary Theresa May. Since 2000, the government has introduced 5 major pieces of terrorism legislation, often in response to anticipated events like the supposed plot against the Queen. A theater of fear has persisted worldwide, with all of the roles inhabited by government patsies time and time again. In order to pass illegal, liberty-destroying legislation, how is this latest threat any different? In the words of Thomas Jefferson, when government fears the people, there is liberty. When the people fear the government, there is tyranny. John Bound for InfoWars.com.
And now I'm going to play a clip from last week of General Michael Flynn, retired, the former head of the Defense Intelligence Agency, saying U.S. made willful decision to support ISIS in Syria. And I've had Colonel Schaefer on, who is graduated above the military now and is involved in very secretive intelligence operations. And he says basically the entire military, Army, Marines, Air Force, Navy are very upset, as you know, 2.5 years ago, saying no to attacking Syria, no to giving them air support for the rebels, because they estimate from on-the-ground assessments 96% of the rebels are foam-at-the-mouth Salafist, al-Nusra, al-Qaeda, Wahhabist. They fly al-Qaeda flags. They attack resuppliers when they're trying to give them weapons. They hate Americans and Westerners so much. It is joke level. And, of course, you've heard whistleblowers, CIA contractor retired, Tosh Plumlee on, who was given from NATO folks 3 years ago when all this first went down, the intel. And Congress has been briefed. They know. And so that's why the Pentagon's like coming out going, yep, we were ordered to do this. It's al-Qaeda. We don't like it. They even sent General Dempsey in, as you know, 2.5 years ago, to tell Obama the military is not going to stand for this. They were going to attack him, and now Obama has announced air support for the rebels against Assad. There are no good rebels. Syria did nothing to us. Assad is good compared to these people. He's good compared to Gaddafi. It's like Assad's good compared to Gaddafi. Gaddafi's good compared to these people. Saddam is good compared to these people. But he did some stuff at least. These people have done nothing. It's one of the few safe havens in the Middle East where Christians, Jews, and non-radical Muslims live in peace. And our government is destroying the country over 5 years, killing 300,000 people. And now using the scum army they've let breed. Again, they don't run the army. They put a big vat out in the woods of stagnant water so the mosquitoes can breed in it. And now the globalists are walking around selling mosquito repellent to everybody. Mosquito repellent. They're not even trying to kill the mosquitoes. They're just selling us anti-mosquito systems. These expensive things they put on your houses that don't work too well. And it is disgusting. So here's that clip.
For the sake of our viewers, in 2012, your agency was saying, quote, the Salafists, the Muslim Brotherhood, and Al-Qaeda in Iraq are the major forces driving the insurgency in Syria. Mm-hmm. In 2012, the US was helping coordinate arms transfers to those same groups. Why did you not stop that, if you're worried about the rise of, quote-unquote, Islamic extremism?
I mean, I hate to say it's not my job, but that my job was to ensure that the accuracy of our intelligence that was being presented was as good as it could be. And I will tell you, it goes before 2012. I mean, when we were in Iraq, and we still had decisions to be made before there was a decision to pull out of Iraq in 2011. I mean, it was very clear what we were going to face.
Well, I admire your frankness
very
on this
clear
subject.
What we were going to
let
face.
Let me just, to, one before we move on, just to clarify once more, you are basically saying that even in government at the time, you knew those groups were around, you saw this analysis,
sure.
and you were arguing against it. But who wasn't listening?
I think the administration.
The administration turned a blind eye to your analysis.
I don't know if they turned a blind eye. I think it was a decision. I think it was a willful decision.
A willful decision to go support an insurgency that had Salafists, Al-Qaeda,
well,
and Muslim Brotherhood.
A willful decision to do what they're doing, which you'd have to really ask the president, what is it that he actually is doing with the policy that is in place? Because it is very, very confusing. I'm sitting here today, Matty, and I can't tell you exactly what that is. And I've been at this for a long time.
Okay, well, let's go back to Iran.
Powerful video. Sometimes when you play videos out of the computer, they play off sync. We're going to fix that video, resync the audio, and play it again, or the media will say it's a fake clip and because the audio was about a half second off. But that's an extremely powerful admission. And you heard him say, look, I was just following orders. But my job was to give accurate intelligence. And yes, we were funding Al-Qaeda. And then Jeb Bush, we played the clip yesterday, gets up in a speech Tuesday and says, we need to take out Assad to stop ISIS. I mean, that is such an insult to everyone's intelligence. That's like saying the Pacific Ocean is off the coast of New York. I mean, it's that big a flaming lie. No, the Atlantic Ocean is. And I'm not even joking around here with my analogy. I mean, Assad and his government and his people, he's very popular in Syria. He was democratizing the country. He was working with the West. He got set up. And they turned loose a bunch of Saudi Arabian nutbags and others they recruited to run around murdering everybody. And our government is funding it, just like they're funding and pushing selling baby parts. Bad people run the government. They're illegitimate at the top. Most of the people in the FBI, in the local police, in the military, are upstanding, hardworking, good people, like the head of the Defense Intelligence Agency. But they're given orders by criminals. And at a certain point, you got to stop following the orders. And that happened 2.5 years ago. The globalists blinked. The Pentagon was told by its officers, we're not doing this. We're not going to, we've already been funding them, giving them weapons. We're not going to be their Air Force. This is crazy. And they had to back off. Now they're back again. And now they got Jeb Bush, the Republican, connected to narcotics, trafficking, everything else, saying we need to attack Assad and that he's with Iran and all this stuff when we just made a deal with Iran. But it doesn't matter. Assad's not offensively working with Iran. Assad's working with whoever he can to not be defeated. It doesn't matter. You don't offensively attack somebody that hasn't done anything to you. Here's Jeb Bush.
We and our partners should declare a no-fly zone in Syria and then work to expand that zone to prevent more crimes by the regime. Enforce that no-fly zone and we'll stop the regime's bombing raids that kill helpless citizens. It could also help stop Iranian flights from resupplying the regime and Hezbollah and other bad actors. A no-fly zone is a critical strategic step to cut off Assad, counter Iranian influence, keep the pressure.
Let's hit pause. Do you understand that when Al-Qaeda double-crossed the West and went back into Iraq to resupply, that we officially asked Iran and their top general to lead attacks to stop them taking the whole country over? Do you realize they've actually, because Al-Qaeda got out of control, have actually let Iranians in to fight them? I mean, Jeb Bush, it's just crazy town to sit there and listen to him talk. So now they want to flip back to supporting the Al-Qaeda rebels openly again and start bombing. And notice that's what Obama's saying, too. This is so Machiavellian now, they don't even know which side they're on. Because at a certain point, all this double dealing, all this quadruple dealing, it just becomes a disaster. Historically, that always happens. These people think they're so sophisticated, so duplicitous, that they have a method of their madness. But pretty soon, they're just confused. Let's go back to the end of the clip.
Pressure on for a settlement and prevent more needless death in a country that has seen so much of it.
Pause again. It's the West that started the attack on Syria 5 years ago on record and gave chemical weapons to Al-Qaeda to attack. Again, it's reality turned upside down. Go back to it.
When we talk about no-fly zones in Syria, precision airstrikes in Iraq, or any projection of military power to meet or deter threats, all of this assumes that such power is there when we need it. Yet here as well, the short-sightedness of the present administration will leave a cost. We're in the seventh year of a significant dismantling of our own military.
That's enough.
In almost inverse proportion to the...
That's enough. He goes on to blame Iraq on the Democrats when it's his brother. I am your host, Alex Jones, and I'm simply trying to get the public to focus in on the real issues and the incredibly historical things that are unfolding right in front of us. In the final equation, it's so key to realize that individuals have power, what we stand for, what we purchase, what we say, what we talk about, how we vote, not just at the ballot box, but at the grand jury box and the jury box. And when we vote on Yelp or we vote on TripAdvisor or we vote on the internet, all of that has a massive effect and shows us that it is the knowledge of the crowd. Historically, any philosopher will tell you that ends up being more knowledgeable and having a greater deep wisdom than the social engineers themselves. And that's if you have social engineers that mean well. Now, I want to be clear. We have a giant unwashed masses out there, maybe half the population that is in a trance that cannot find their rear ends with both hands, as we say. But of the group within the mass that's awake and involved and having their voice heard and that cares enough to fill out a card at the restaurant about what they thought about the service or click on the internet vote or make the internet comment or say something about the hotel they stayed at or send a letter to Congress, those people give most the charity. They do most the community work. They're involved the most. They're the people that actually care about civilization and society. And in Canadian, British, and U.S. studies, you can just search engine this, conservatives and libertarians are 6 times more likely to give money, 6 times more likely to be involved in charity, 6 times more likely to be involved in their communities or to volunteer for the military. And in the inverse, those calling themselves liberals and environmentalists are 6 times more likely to not give money and to steal and to not physically volunteer. And I'll tell you why that is. Because modern conservatives and libertarians, who aren't perfect, there's a diverse group of people, are the liberals. If you go back to 1776, they were called liberals. They have, again, flipped everything on its head. Where Planned Parenthood loves the black people when it was founded to kill the black people. George Soros is a top Nazi living collaborator. Should have been in Nuremberg trial. He is the most highly decorated member with awards from the ADL, the leftist Jewish organization. It is, again, a sickening joke. A sickening, ridiculous, macabre hallucination. Now, I want to get into more of the news. I've already mentioned quite a bit of it, but I haven't drilled into it yet. I want to get into the economy. Peter Schiff's joining us on that front. We'll have open phones for him and then totally open phones. It'll be a free-for-all to quote the great Second Amendment champion Ted Nugent in the start of the third hour. In fact, we ought to get that song. I got me a rock and roll band. It's free-for-all. I got me a radio show, TV show, with 20 million listeners and viewers a week. It's a free-for-all. No teleprompters, none of it. Just raw love of liberty, raw research, raw common sense, toe-to-toe with high-tech brainwashing. So before I get to any more of this news and a on-the-street video report shot right after they walked out of the theater, I love these movie reviews that Jakari Jackson and Kit Daniels do together because they're good buddies and go out and play pool together and stuff like that and sports. So they also go to movies. Sometimes McAdoo goes out with the crew as well and joins them. But straight out of Compton, what they're not telling you, a movie review by Jakari Jackson and Kit Daniels, that's coming up in the final segment of this hour as well. Before I get into Jeb Bush pushing torture, let me tell you about some of the exciting developments at InfoWarsLife.com. There are so many amazing products at InfoWarsLife.com, but amongst them is BrainForce. And I wanted to give you a review by Loss from Panorama City, California, on BrainForce. Didn't think much was happening. Was taking it for a week with the secret B12. I cannot stress enough that brain body is missing. When I skipped it one day, I felt like I was either missing screws or loose screws in my head. Great for concentration and focus. I take it after lunch for energy and the rest of the day, thanks to all the info warriors. Yeah, that's the thing. When I don't take BrainForce, I feel it. And that's what's so amazing about it. Somebody ran off with my open bottle. So I need to take one. Or no, it was put down here. When I don't take the BrainForce, that's when I notice it. And I actually didn't take my BrainForce today. And I'm still awake, still have a lot of energy. But this doesn't have the classical stimulants in it. It has key compounds you can read about on the website, watch informational videos about. I won't waste your time with it. If you're interested, go read about it. That are prescription in Europe. Two of the ingredients prescription in Europe. And they're trying to make them prescription here. And I've, again, been in to talk to medical doctors, had my blood tested a year ago and again 6 months ago. And these are the things that they're pushing by prescription now because they just add cofactors to it. So this is a true nutraceutical, incredibly low priced, 10 powerful ingredients known to give you clean, focused, basically warm energy. Available at InfoWarsLife.com. It was sold out for several months, 2.5 months. It is back in, and at current sales rates, it'll be sold out sometime this weekend. If you want to try BrainForce or read the reviews, it's available at InfoWarsLife.com or by calling toll-free 888-253-3139. Also, not only has BrainForce gotten back in stock, Super Male Vitality is now back in stock. And let me find some of those reviews for you. Again, we have new ones every day. 4.8 reviews for both of these products out of 5 stars by third-party review sites. Truly unprecedented. An average of 4.8. Some are 5 stars, some are 4.4, but the average is 4.8. Super Male Vitality, Jack in Seattle, Washington. I use Super Male Vitality every day to stay energized and focused. I can work longer hours and still put in hard workouts afterwards. Gives me energy to work out and helps me put on lean muscle. I can really feel the difference in my workouts and life in general. Love this product and buy it regularly. I take it with X2 in the morning instead of coffee. I would recommend this to a friend. Thank you so much for supporting us, Jack, and I'm glad you had a good response. We try stuff out for 6 months to a year after different variations before we even sell it. And I've never been a vitamin or nutraceutical guy. In the last 4 or 5 years, I've lost 60-plus pounds, slowly getting back into shape from gaining 98 pounds and not working out for 15 years. Because I thought they'd kill me any minute 15 years ago when they physically attacked me and were death-threatening me. And I just, yeah, I'm just going to go eat a steak. I'm going to drink a six-pack of beer at night. I don't care. I'm going to quit working out. I was the opposite of a narcissist. And I just was kind of letting myself go. And so I slowly started bike riding and slowly started exercising, but I could lose 10, 15 pounds, but the rest of it stayed on me. Once I began taking Beyond Tangy Tangerine from InfoWarsHealth.com, a longevity product, I lost about 20-something pounds because I was not as hungry because I was missing all these minerals and trace elements that mainstream media says you don't need, but Dr. Wallach's research shows you do. And deficiency is such a big part of it. And then I researched iodine, the best forms of that, got on Survival Shield NX2. Like this morning I put in a bottle of water when I went to work out, 2 squirts of Super Male, which isn't as strong as under the tongue, but I like it that way, and a squirt of X2. And then I drank that. So I've got a ton of energy, felt great. I'd forgotten to take the Brain Force because I'm just not a vitamin mineral guy. But when I do remember to take 7 or 8 of the products a day and to do the Beyond Tangy Tangerine, which I give my children every day, it's just amazing. And then I asked myself, why aren't I taking all the InfoWars Life and InfoWars Health products when I'm here endorsing it and have seen such an incredible response? And it's because I'm not a habit-driven guy. I'm not dominated by it, and it's very hard to start new habits, but if we'll just start the new habit, these nutraceuticals have been game changers. You've heard the rave reviews, and then there's the added bonus. You're funding a hair on fire, foam at the mouth, 110% committed organization. And as one of the greatest samurai said, desperateness is the way of the samurai. 100 men can't kill such a man. And that's absolutely true. We're going into this 110%. And I just want to thank you, and I'm humbled that you do support us so we can continue the operation at this level and hopefully expand in the face of the globalists, because I want to go all the way. So these are war bonds. When you buy the books, the videos, the T-shirts, the ball caps, the shortwave radios, the non-GMO seeds, the high-quality water filters at InfoWarsStore.com. And then subdivisions of InfoWarsStore.com are made in 1776.com. And that's the Made in America products. And then you've got, if you want to get them cheaper from other parts of the world, we got the regular apparel area. And we got InfoWarsHealth.com, the longevity products. And then we've got InfoWarsLife.com. It's our proprietary products. All there at InfoWarsStore.com. Okay, I'm done ranting. I'm not going to plug again this hour, but I've been forgetting to plug and skipping breaks the last few months, and we're a little bit behind. So I've been doing some mid-air refueling to fund the operation here, especially with this what looks like a depression coming up. And it's more essential than ever to support our local AM and FM affiliates, to tell them thank you for carrying the show, to become a sponsor locally, even if it's small or large, or to support local sponsors. That is as important as supporting InfoWarsStore.com. So thank you. I salute you and want to just absolutely commend you for that. You know what? I think I'm going to air the Straight Outta Compton piece right now with Jakari Jackson and Kit Daniels as we analyze culture, analyze media, because so much of the propaganda is embedded in media, not even so much news. We know the news twists things now, or the talking points that news do. But so much of it, I'd say 80% of the propaganda is in movies and TV, and you see that message. So I appreciate Jakari and Kit going out and getting the job done on this report. Here is that report, and we'll come back with the latest on the buildup for war with Russia, and then Jeb Bush on torture tactics, saying they're effective. That's like saying child molestation is effective or arson is effective. It's illegal, you little beady-eyed jackass commie. Slimy Kenny Bunkport, blue blood, been feeding on the East Coast back since your family were Tories in the Revolutionary War and setting up Skull and Bones and then Nazi collaborators and now urinating all over us. Excuse me. Just with Republicans like this guy, there's no wonder we're in so much trouble, and John Boehner and all the rest of these scum. And it's not good to make it personal with these gangsters. They can just make a call and have you killed. But what's gotten us in this position is cowering to this filth. And somebody's got to stand up against them. Just tell it like it is. Let's go ahead and go to that report.
Kit Daniels here with Jakari Jackson, who's behind the camera. We just got out of the Alamo Draft House, and we just saw the latest movie, Straight Outta Compton, about the legendary hip-hop group NWA. Now, overall, I definitely recommend the movie. It was way better than I thought it would be. You know how a lot of movies are kind of hyped up beforehand? This was no exception. But this movie almost lived up to the hype. And even if you're not a big fan of hip-hop, I definitely still recommend it just so you could see a glimpse of popular culture as well as the history of the late 80s and early 90s at the time. Now, there was one scene in the movie that I thought was very interesting, was the musicians were at a press conference after they were arrested in Detroit after a riot. And I think it was Ice Cube who said that their art, meaning their music, reflected their reality. Now, the reality at the time was, and it's still true today, is that the CIA controls the international drug trade. And they do that to mainly so they can fund their black op operations, you know, the kind of off-the-book things, you know, where they overthrow governments and who knows what else they do. And in order and for them to create this demand for drugs, back in the 80s, they used these various intermediaries, you know, such as music executives, to push hip-hop to the forefront above rock and roll. And to glamorize the drug trade and drugs to ensure that there was a demand for drugs from the American inner youth to ensure that the CIA would still keep getting money off the drugs they were importing through the country. And it was back in 1996 that a journalist by the name of Gary Webb, who was writing for the San Jose Mercury News, he revealed that a former drug kingpin in the 80s, Freeway Rick Ross, one of his cocaine connections was actually tied to the CIA, and that created a huge scandal. Now, Rick Ross was on the Alex Jones show back in November, and he said this.
I'm letting you know right now that the establishment is using hip-hop to prime these kids for a life that's going to send them to prison, just like they did with me. See, when I was coming up, there was Superfly, Tequila Sunrise, Scarface. All these movies to make you think that you could start with nothing and then you could have the whole world at the palm of your hand. Only that there was no pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. It was a set of handcuffs and shackles. And you want to know why the CIA symbol is behind me? Because they were the guys behind me when I was selling drugs. And now they're behind hip hop and rock and roll. This prison, hip-hop connection, they're behind that too.
If it was good for them to sell drugs, then it should have been good for me to sell drugs. The money from the drugs went to buy guns for the country.
Even if you don't read my book, warn your kids, let them know. But I advise you that this book is worth reading. Definitely for your kids. Even if you don't read it, get it for your kids, get it for your loved ones. Let them see what the drug culture is all about.
So to sum it all up, the drugs that you saw in the movie and the drug lifestyle and the decadence of the inner city, that was all created by the CIA to ensure that there was still a demand for drugs and to bolster the CIA's profits. Now, Jakari, what did you think about the movie?
Thank you, Kit. Now, if I could take one quote away from this movie, it was when the guys were all together at a press conference and somebody brought up the point that we have AK-47s from Russia, none of us have a passport. We have drugs coming in from South America, none of us have a passport. It reminded me of that line in Boys of the Hood where Lawrence Fishburne is talking about, we don't have any planes, we don't have any ships. How does this cocaine get here? And it goes on to the point that Kit was bringing about, that even these guys rap about this stuff, they're not the ones who actually bring this stuff into the country. And there's another aspect, the free speech aspect that Ice Cube touches on in the movie, and I think he is still a vocal free speech proponent to this day, that these guys have the right to go out and say whatever they want to say, and talking about their situations, their involvement with the police. Now, if there is a villain in this movie besides Eazy-E's manager, the police are definitely the villain, but these guys are talking about what they see. That was their experience growing up in Compton, that
all
the
right,
police would harass
we're going
them
to
do
break
other types of things.
The full report, what they're not telling you about Straight out of Compton, is up on Infowars.com. We're going to come back and get into torture. They're back promoting that this time, and they're pushing war with Russia and the survivability of it. This is insanity. Stay with us. FBI examines have backed up elsewhere. Majority support criminal probe, classified data found in May. I mean, she blocks for over a year releasing it and then releases it professionally wiped. That is obstruction of justice. She's convicted. 5 to 10 years in federal prison is the precedent. The statute's 10 years for obstruction in a felony case. Willful, wanton, premeditated, organized, professionally done. And whoever did it with her is guilty. I mean, that's one of the first things that they teach people in criminology. One of the first things they teach at places like Quantico. Every FBI agent knows that. This is a hardcore crime in front of everyone, but so is being the head of the State Department and taking money from third world dictators. And then the next day in some cases, after she'd get $1 million from foreign governments in one case, they would take the export ban off weapons. And remember, Tosh Plumlee exposed it, later came out. Who was allowing the weapons transfers outside of congressional approval? The State Department. Hillary Clinton. But see, the elite want to put her in as president because she's so blackmailable. Man, that's amazing. That's some of the headlines up on drudgereport.com. Infowars.com has some really good news. Judge on abortion videos. There's been six of them now. Gag order is a restraint on the First Amendment. That's exactly what I said. That the previous judge was trying to declare the abortion videos a state secret and violate the First Amendment. The decision brings us one step closer to a day it's just amazing that that's going on. Simply amazing that that's all unfolding. Now, before we go any further, I'm going to talk more about this after Peter Schiff leaves us because it's a pretty big deal. But classified Pentagon exercise reveals U.S. would struggle to win war with Russia. That's like saying secret classified Pentagon report reveals that ducks swim around in ponds and that bears live in woods and that dogs have hair and that whales spout water and that Easter bunnies aren't real and that Santa Claus isn't real and that Obama's a big fat liar and that 2 + 2 = 4, even if he says it doesn't, and raising the debt limit does raise the debt limit, and you can't keep your doctor and it will increase your Obamacare prices and you did build your business. Classified Pentagon exercise reveals U.S. would struggle to win war with Russia. It would take everything we had. Really? What happens once nuclear war starts and they got 20,000 nukes and the U.S. has 20,000 nukes? How's all the Rothschild and Rockefeller and Queen Elizabeth Heil Hitler money then? How's all the Bush Nazi gold going to be worth anything when it's got a half-billion-year half-life on it? I mean, I look at Jeb Bush and his beady eyes all sweaty up there and Hillary. I mean, these are sacks of garbage. These are bags of you-know-what. Of dog crap. And I hate to use those analogies, but they just fit. They are sacks of criminal activity, of their dirtbags. And we just sit here and bow down to them while they commit all these crimes in front of us. I'm sick of all of them. And Boehner and all those snot noses. We need somebody like Rand Paul. Or even the female Republican candidate, at least she was a CEO, and she says you shouldn't have to take vaccines. It's not a radical statement, it's common sense. Any of these people are better. The physician's great. I'd vote for him. I'm just sick of all of this garbage. The people were being force-fed by the establishment. The people being given all the billions in money. Hillary and Jeb, that's who you don't support. When we come back, Jeb's pushing torture. I will get to it. We are back live, ladies and gentlemen. Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com are the news websites. A news story up on Infowars.com by Steve Watson is very important. Judge on abortion videos. Gag order is a restraint on First Amendment. The decision brings us one step closer to the day that STEM Express and Planned Parenthood have been dreading. The Superior Court of the State of California has ruled that biomedical company STEM Express cannot legally suppress the release of videos obtained by the Center for Medical Progress and does not have any right to the footage or documents that the anti-abortion activists have obtained. Yeah, especially when there's evidence of what appears to be criminal activity. Los Angeles Superior Court Judge Joanne O'Donnell explained that the restraining order taken out against CMP will no longer stand, and it represents a restraint on the First Amendment rights. Yeah, they've lied and said it's edited videos. They released the full video. I'm doing like 5.5-hour videos and stuff. And it's even worse when you sit there. I sat up one night and like scanned through a 5.5-hour video. I probably watched 2 hours of it. And I mean, it's just the smacking of the lips and the guzzling of the wine, you know, all the videos and the restaurants and the puffery and the sycophantic nature of these chicken neck weak ghouls, these grave robbers. I mean, it's just unbelievable. They're not even grave robbers. They're chopping up living people. They're body snatchers, vampires, Jeffrey Dahmers. I mean, I don't know what you call people that chop up little kids, or they pull them out, keep them alive, wheel the woman out drugged, get the organs out, and you sit around talking about Lamborghinis and everything while you eat fancy food and drink wine. I mean, it's the image of serial killers with women in cages in front of them with a big banquet table heaped with meat and fruit and, you know, honey glazed giblets enjoying themselves. The injunction plaintiff seeks would prevent defendants from disseminating the videotapes, said the judge. First, the proposed injunction would constitute a prior restraint on the defendant's right under the First Amendment and the parallel protections under California Constitution. Plaintiffs does not persuade the court that the discovery it seeks is necessary to obtain the preliminary injunction. This is because it appears unlikely the court is going to grant the preliminary injunction, Judge O'Donnell said yesterday. The ruling means the CMP will be able to release the remaining footage it has on STEM Express employees without fear of reprisal. Attorneys working with the CMP believe justice has prevailed. That's the thing about whistleblowing. If you were in somebody's house and you'd been let into the house, and let's just say you believed you were there as swingers or whatever to have sex with a couple, and then you release that video without them knowing, you're super liable. I don't care what state you're in. You're going to end up doing jail time or getting fined because nobody's hurting anybody, even if you think that's immoral. But when you're sitting around at a restaurant talking about selling body parts and you met in a meeting with somebody, it's covered under the First Amendment. But whistleblowing goes further than that. If you work in a company or a government institution and they're laundering money, they're selling drugs out the back, they're doing whatever it is that's illegal, and you videotape that and expose it, it doesn't matter if you're in a two-party consent state under wiretapping, because that's exempt when you're exposing a crime. You have a responsibility under the Good Samaritan Code in common law that's expressed throughout all Western law to render aid, or if you know a crime's being committed, to report it, or to physically try to stop it. And what really makes civilizations rise is when people are civically involved and themselves ferreting out corruption and exposing it. Now, that doesn't mean you tattle on your neighbor because their 10-year-old's playing in the backyard till 6 at night because you're at work. That means you also go after real crime, not nanny state BS. So there's a delicate balance there as well. We'll be back. Well, Joe Biden, the guy that promised he wouldn't come after any of our guns, is now basically getting ready to run for president, saying he's just going to run for one term. We'll break that down at the bottom of the hour. Clinton has finally handed over her server after it was professionally wiped clean. That is obstruction of justice in a felony case. You're talking 10 years in the statutory law, federal prison. That's 9.5 years she would serve. But she runs the Justice Department. I mean, the Clintons run Obama. But it's just getting too naked, too out in the open. She makes Richard Nixon look like a good person, a anti-corruption good boy. We've had an earthquake rattle New Jersey. The map is up on Infowars.com and DrudgeReport.com, and a pretty good size one for that area, an M2.7, all sorts of weird geological stuff happening around the world. They say, of course, San Francisco is due to have a 7 or larger any time now, according to the computer program models. Coming up, there's a new video that's going viral. They're back. Donald gives hope to black lives. Trump, I'll face Biden in general election after Clinton unravels. And they're talking about Hillary, again, being a time bomb, the Democratic Party. But, I mean, really, no one can believe that she still hasn't dropped out of the race. But I mean, don't expect that. She's the lady that's getting most of the money. She's the lady the establishment's behind. And they can play the whole thing. You just don't like women, like Bernie Sanders said on Monday in a CNN interview. We played the clip. He said, it's sexist to criticize Hillary. I think she's a great person doing a great job. I mean, then what are you running against? And then he's a socialist. So that's all coming up. Up on InfoWars.com by Steve Watson. Judge on abortion videos. Gag order is restraint on First Amendment rights. Special report. They're now saying Al-Qaeda slash ISIS is set to hit and try to kill the queen this weekend, this Saturday. I think that's just fear-mongering to take more liberties. They're now pushing tracker chips for welfare recipients. We've got the report right there at InfoWars.com. Classified Pentagon exercise reveals U.S. would struggle to win war with Russia. It would take everything we had. 46 million Americans go to food banks and long lines for dwindling food supplies. The lines begin at 6:30 a.m. across the country, and food banks are running out. 100 million people are on some form of food assistance, but 46 million are on direct assistance. Imagine a food line, soup kitchens, with 100 million people a day lined up. But instead, it's all digital, so it's hidden. Also, video services showing Ferguson shooter Tyrone Harris. Video shows Ferguson shooter Tyrone Harris flashing a gun at Mike Brown protest. And again, there's video of him pulling a gun out on the cops and getting shot. And then again, they go, oh my gosh, they killed him because he's black. No, if I pull a gun on the cops randomly, they're going to shoot me. Does that mean there isn't some discrimination against blacks in some areas? Absolutely. But is it the number one issue in America? No. The media pushes it for divide and conquer and will not touch the really big issues. That's some of the news up on InfoWars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. Now, we have Peter Schiff joining us for the balance of the hour. I appreciate him coming on short notice, but there's four or five financial guests we have on that pretty much line up on a lot of the same issues, but they have different perspectives from their life experiences. And, you know, I can't tell you which one I think is the most accurate. They're all really accurate. Peter Schiff's had about a 98% accuracy rate until he said a few years ago that he thought the bubble would bust by then. But if you look at the third world, I mean, I'm not defending him, it's just a fact. If you look at what's happening in the old world, there's depressions in most areas of the planet. In South America, Central America, most of Africa, the Middle East, a lot of Eastern Europe, Asia. Japan's been in a recession for 20 years. But now it's clearly going belly up. And more analysts, from Ron Paul to you name it, are saying they believe the day of reckoning's here. Now, we had Mr. Dent on yesterday with his demographic cliff, and he was very bold and said he believes we're in a dead cat bounce. Within 2 weeks, the Chinese stock market's going to start racing down. He believes it'll pull the other major ones down and that there's going to be a real estate bubble popping by the end of this year. So we'll get Schiff's take on that. But I also want to walk through the election with Schiff, what he really thinks about Trump, what he thinks about Hillary. I mean, just the state of this country. How can there be confidence in anything when criminals are running absolutely free and the IRS is now persecuting over 100,000 people, admittedly jailing hundreds of people a year for their political views? That's now come out in her emails, how she's going to get Republicans and get conservatives. Peter Schiff's father is one of the most famous anti-New World Order patriots for people that are older. He's been in jail for, what is it, a decade? I don't mean to get into that story. We only mentioned it last time. He's been on the show probably 50 times and never talked about it. He used to come on my show in 95, 96, 97, 98, right through the 2000s. And then the judge, federal judge, said, you keep publishing your book saying the IRS is a fraud and a collection agency for the Federal Reserve, I'm going to put you in prison. He is in jail for the First Amendment. A true political prisoner. So now we see this is happening. And they've issued one tax exemption to a conservative group in 3 years, 10,000 plus to Democrats. This is a tyranny. And it's bipartisan, but the Democrats are the tip of the spear. So I want to get your economic prognosis. Of course, Europac.com, billions under management, host the Peter Schiff Show, and a lot more. You can find out details at Europac.com. I've thrown out probably 10 different stories or more since you've been holding 5 minutes. What would you like to tackle first? I mean, I'd kind of like to just get into politics first, just as an American, to get your view on just all of this insanity. How much more crazy can it get?
Well, probably the craziest thing is how popular Bernie Sanders is, right? I mean, you've got an admitted socialist who is drawing the largest crowds. Is that me?
Yeah, I think that is you. It's okay. Yeah. Hey, he's good to have a newsroom. It's busy. It's real world.
He's getting the largest crowds. He's leading in some of the polls. I mean, most Democrats, you know, there are a lot of them that are socialists, but they don't come out of the closet. They don't admit it. This guy is not, you know, ashamed of being a socialist. And look how many Americans want to vote for him.
He may be the Democratic frontrunner.
Yeah, you know, and of course, you know, Hillary is self-destructing, so that's probably helping it. That's probably why Biden wants to get in, because he doesn't want to leave it to Bernie Sanders. He probably senses there's some vulnerability there. But, you know, the Democrats want to jump all over the Republicans because of Donald Trump. But look at how many Democrats are going for Sanders. I mean, remember, I did that video last year at the Democratic National Convention. If you haven't seen it, it's on my YouTube channel.
I've seen it.
Yeah, and I asked if they would be in favor of a law banning corporate profits. And these were the delegates to the Democratic Convention, and they were in favor of it. They said, yeah, let's ban profits. They're all socialists there, and now you've got one of their own coming out and admitting it, and he's leading in the polls. This is where the nation is going.
And you predicted it in that viral video. We'll play some of that at the bottom of the hour once we pull it up. But again, it's on the Peter Schiff YouTube site. In fact, I'm glad you raised that, because you were Ron Paul in the first campaign, Congressman Ron Paul's chief economic advisor, as a top Austrian economist in your own right. What would you be advising Rand Paul to get back in the lead to do right now if you were his advisor?
Well, you know, I gave Rand my advice. Hopefully, you know, he will heed it. I mean, I think it's good. But, you know, rather than attacking Donald Trump, right, I don't think that is the right strategy.
I don't either.
Donald Trump is hitting a nerve where he is appealing to the people within the Republican Party who are fed up with both parties and who are fed up with career politicians and want something different. And I think a lot of those Donald Trump voters can really be Rand Paul voters in transition, because Rand Paul is not a career politician. Just because he's a U.S. senator, he never was in politics until he won that seat. And he ran for Senate as an eye doctor, as a small businessman. That's how he needs to run president, the way he ran for Senate, because the field is crowded with career politicians. And the only one right now that's standing out is Donald Trump. But he needs to get those Trump voters. He needs to wait for those Trump voters to evolve and realize that the real outsider in this race, the real game changer, the real break from the establishment in the Republican Party and the Democratic Party is Rand Paul, not Donald Trump.
Sure. And I mean, Trump's hooked in with the Democrats and all the rest of it. Do you think, though, Trump's for real? Because he is, you know, he has a big ego. To be successful, you got to have it. I mean, I think the guy's really smart. I like almost everything he's saying. Do you think, though, he might not just want to be a stepping stone for the Democrats and Hillary and Biden? I mean, maybe he really wants to be president. I mean, I think Donald Trump be a lot better than Jeb Bush or Hillary Clinton.
Well, the bar is pretty low there. So, yeah, he might be. But, you know, he wouldn't be as good as Rand. But,
I agree.
You know, obviously, the guy would like to be president. I mean, who wouldn't want to be president if somebody just was going to make you president? The problem is getting elected. It's very difficult. I don't think this is some kind of plant to try to help elect a Democrat. I mean, I don't think he's in it for that reason. But some of it might be ego. I mean, it's something that he might want to do. I mean, you know, it's one of the only things really you can't buy. I mean, Trump can have whatever is for sale. And generally, the White House is not, at least not for the people who occupy it. Maybe it's for sale to the people who make all the donations. But, you know, I think the candidacy really says a lot about you know, the country and where we are. I don't think he can win the nomination. I think when the field narrows, it will be harder. Sure, when you got 15 people and they're all the same and Trump's the only one that's different, he's like the none of the above vote, right?
I mean, exactly. He's not perfect, but if you're out in the ocean, a piece of driftwood is like an oasis. And so Trump's the only one that's not a complete, you know, buffoon, anti-American piece of garbage.
Yeah, and, you know, a lot of the things that he says are right. He's right to be concerned about our deteriorating trade balance, about our escalating national debt, but he doesn't really articulate the right solutions. It's not about just hiring smarter negotiators. That's not what's going to do it. We have to radically transform this country back to what it used to be. We need massive cuts in government spending. We need to abolish agencies and departments. We need free markets. We need to get rid of this welfare state. We need to acknowledge the problems that exist. You know, you talked earlier about, you know, the fact that we haven't had this day of reckoning yet, because the masses still believe that the Federal Reserve saved us. They still think their policy worked. They still think there's a real recovery here. They still think the Fed is going to embark on rate tightening. That isn't even close to true.
Let's talk about it. Let's start walking through it, because I skipped this network break to give you more time. What we just saw in China, what we are seeing in Greece, what we're seeing with the yuan being lowered. Walk us through each of those and then give us the big picture.
But first of all, nobody is talking about the real story of the Chinese yuan, right? People are missing this. Everybody's focusing on the devaluation, which is tiny, 2 or 3%. What is important is the principle here. China said that they want their currency not to necessarily be pegged to the dollar, but to kind of reflect fundamentals. Everybody forgets that the dollar has risen maybe 30% against a basket of currencies over the past couple of years. That means the Chinese yuan has also risen by the same percentage because it's been pegged to the dollar. And China is saying, we don't want to be pegged to the dollar. We want our currency to be more in line with other currencies. And the big problem is going to happen when the dollar reverses. This is a dollar bubble. And so the next time the dollar starts to go down, China's not going to catch it. China's not going to have our back. When the dollar was falling from 2001 to 2008, China was there to keep buying U.S. treasuries and mitigate the dollar's decline. And in the currency wars in 2010 and 2011, China was buying dollars and buying treasuries to prevent its currency from rising.
So that, this is huge. You're saying now that they're going to let the yuan just basically free fall and not back the dollar up. Could this signify the end of dollar hegemony?
No, what I'm saying is when this dollar bubble bursts and the dollar starts to fall, right, the Chinese are going to let their currency rise. They're not going to try to keep their currency weak with the dollar. They're not going to buy all these treasuries to suppress the value of the yuan. They're going to let their currency rise with all the other currencies of the world.
Oh, so you see it as that they're going to stop manipulating their currency and just let it float.
They're not going to let it freely float, but they will manage it higher, just like they've managed it lower. And that is bad news for the U.S., because that means upward pressure on long-term interest rates.
Sure.
That means consumer prices are going to go up, because the Chinese have been helping to keep our inflation in check by absorbing it for us. They've been taking the bullets for us. But what the Chinese are now saying to anybody who's smart enough to listen is they're not going to do that anymore. We are on our own. When the dollar starts to fall, we're not going to count on China to provide that cushion like it did before, which means we're going to have to deal with the impact of a weak dollar with higher domestic consumer prices and higher long-term interest rates. And this could be the beginning. This is like the first shot that nobody's heard around the world that ends this currency war, and the United States ends up being the loser, and we have a real dollar crisis, and then we might actually end up with that hyperinflation. You know, the Keynesians, the Paul Krugmans, they're taking this premature victory laps. They're saying all the people like Peter Schiff who are predicting inflation, it didn't happen. It's going to happen. It's just happening later. And because they engineered this sucker's rally in the dollar's just going to crash from a higher precipice.
Sure.
And the crisis is going to happen later, but means it's going to be that much worse because we've exacerbated all the problems by delaying the consequences.
Now, again, you've been very successful predicting markets. That's how you've made billions of dollars for your clients. I'm just a layperson that sits here and tries to study this and the basics. And I have people on like Harry Dent, and I have people on like you. I have a lot of other analysts on, and they all generally agree we're going towards a bubble implosion, a group of bubble implosions, and that this currency war can't go on forever and QE can't go on forever. But he thinks that they're printing all the money and issuing the money to cover up the deflation. I get we've had some deflation, but at a certain point, Weimar Republic, Zimbabwe, hundreds of other, Mexico, there's a devaluation that comes home, and then the value of the money is lost in every case in history. So I don't understand how then we're not going to see faster inflation. Explain to me the two different schools of thought, because both ways are bad. And then tell us, do you think things are deteriorating faster? Is the moment of reckoning about to be here?
Again, we are going to see more inflation. We're already seeing it in ways that are not being measured or called inflation. You got a bubble in the stock market. You got a bubble in real estate market. You've got bubbles going on in rare cars or fine art. Prices are rising all around us, yet it's not considered inflation if it's an asset price that's going up. But it's still inflation that's driving the increase in those prices. Also, rents are rising very sharply. For some reason, that doesn't get captured in the CPI. We know college tuition is rising. We know healthcare costs are rising. Insurance rates are rising. Taxes are rising. We know the price of food is going up. All sorts of prices are rising, yet for some reason, that doesn't show up in the government calculated numbers. I mean, I think that's very convenient, but I don't think it's honest. And I think that anybody that wants to hang their hat on these government created numbers as proof there's no inflation, you know, you have to realize the government has a significant interest in under inflation. And
well, they admit they cook the unemployment numbers, the inflation numbers. I mean, all of it, they admit it's cooked.
Yeah, and the unemployment numbers, you know, the official rate means nothing when you have a collapse in the labor force. We have the lowest labor force participation since 1976. We have the lowest homeownership rate since 1967. People are dropping out in droves. People who are working part-time, they want to work full-time, but those jobs don't exist anymore. Yet they're still counted as being employed just because they have a lousy part-time job. But these numbers don't sell the whole story. The fact that guys like Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump are getting the most crowds, that tells you the real story. The people are fed up. They are not living in a fantasy recovery created by the media or by Wall Street. They're living in the reality of this Obama recession.
So what happens as the fantasy fog lifts? Won't that just accelerate the decline? A, B, if we are going into a major correction, what do you expect it to look like? What could the next shoe to drop be?
Look, the only thing holding it together is the false belief that the Fed has finished printing money, that QE is over, that the Fed's going to raise rates, that it's mission accomplished, right? That everything is fine, right? Well, you know, it wasn't mission accomplished for the war on terror just because George Bush was on an aircraft carrier, you know, declaring that mission was accomplished. Well, it's not accomplished for the Fed, right? They have only just begun to print. This is a pause. QE is not over. QE4, QE5, the Fed is just getting started. The balance sheet is not going to shrink. It is going to explode out of control. It's $4.5 trillion now. It's not going down. It's going up towards $10 trillion. It's going higher. As soon as people get their arms around that reality, then it's going to be like a watershed, right? It's going to be like opening up a dam, and the dollar is going to tumble, and that is going to be a game changer. And China has already said, we're going to get out of the way. We're not going to get drowned in that deluge. We are going to let our currency go up. We're not going to sink with the American Titanic.
Sure. Well, it has sent their stock market back up now for the best in 2 months since they did this. But, I mean, isn't it overvalued? It's doubled in the last few years. And what do you expect to see happen in China? How will that affect us?
The Chinese market is pretty inexpensive. I mean, take a look at it. I mean, the Chinese market is still a lot lower than it was in 2007. I mean, look at the NASDAQ. You want to see something expensive, look over there. You know, people are exaggerating the decline in the Chinese stock market. China's stock market is positive on the year. The U.S. market is down this year. China had a big drop only because it had a huge rally right before. There was a spike in volatility in the Chinese market. That's all. There wasn't a market crash there, and I don't think there's going to be a market crash there. I actually don't even think there's going to be a market crash in the United States. There should be, and if the Fed did the right thing, there would be, but they're not going to do the right thing. They're going to print a lot of money.
Okay, so what's the time frame in your mind then?
Look, something's going to happen by next year because everybody expects the Fed to raise rates this year. And if they do, if they come forward with a meaningless quarter-point rate hike, that's not going to be enough to prop up the dollar. The Fed is going to have to do more. But I think a quarter of a point is too much for this fragile economy. Look at the first half GDP. It was 1.45%. Atlanta Fed GDP now this week, they lowered their forecast for Q3 to 0.7.
Wow.
0.7. A year ago, the economy grew 5% in the third quarter.
Peter Schiff, stay there. I want to come back and walk through this because, again, I'm not an economist like you or a money manager, but it just seems crazy. They're now saying don't raise interest rates because of China. So damn if we do, damn if we don't. Irwin Schiff's his name, best-selling underground author, really great radio interview. He used to be on GCN Radio Network for about 5 years at night, syndicated on at least 50 stations around the country. And he just wrote books explaining that the IRS was never properly ratified for the amendment in 1913. And it was all documented, and that they made you waive your Fourth Amendment rights when you fill out the IRS forms. They also went after a federal Treasury officer, armed officer of the IRS, of course, who we've had on as a frequent guest on this show, Joe Bannister, and twice he had jury trials, and they didn't put him in prison because he had juries. And this was for giving speeches saying the IRS is a fraud. That's like arresting you for saying Planned Parenthood sells body parts. And you know those, 12 different IRS agents that were in full-page ads in USA Today? Of the 12, 9 are in prison. 9. So the IRS is the Gestapo in this country. The IRS is like the KGB or the NKVD, the internal police that politically, the commissars that go after people. And it's shameful. It needs to be abolished. It needs to be gotten rid of. And Rand Paul, of course, has called for that. We need to see that as well from folks like Donald Trump. It can selectively destroy whoever you want. Fortune, money, they've all done it. 30 different tax preparers, 50 different tax preparers. The Wall Street Journal a few years ago had 100. And they gave 100 different answers, 30 different answers, 50 different answers. You cannot pay it correctly. It's designed to screw you over. It's designed to put you in prison. And now we have the emails. We know they're targeting libertarian conservatives. And I was asking him how, because I've never had Peter Schiff, who's separate from his dad, author, researcher, manages billions at Europac.com. I never really bring up his dad, and I brought him up a few weeks ago, 4 weeks ago when he was on. He said, yeah, dad's in prison, got all these years left for publishing this book. He was ordered not to, for saying the IRS is a fraud. That's how scared they are. And I was asking him again, how's your dad? And he said, well, I don't know if I should make this announcement. It's not public yet, but the family would like to get a chance to see him before, and now I'll let Peter Schiff talk about this on air. It's some really sad news for this political prisoner who I knew so well. Peter, tell us about your dad and what's happened.
Yeah, well, he is, a political prisoner. He's not even kind of a pseudo political prisoner. He's the real deal here in the United States because he is in jail for his political beliefs. He's not in jail for breaking any laws. And, you mentioned, the tax code. His real issue has always been that the Internal Revenue Code, the laws were written voluntarily. You hear it's based on voluntary compliance. Well, that means you're not required to pay. And the reason that all the laws were written voluntarily is because otherwise they would have violated numerous provisions of the Constitution. The Constitution is really inconsistent with a mandatory direct tax on your income.
Sure, they get you to opt in to a corporate contract, then that's how they come after you.
It's not really a corporate contract. I mean, the laws were written voluntarily. If you just ask the IRS, is the tax system based on voluntary compliance or compulsory compliance?
They'll tell you.
It's voluntary. And then you'll say, well, but I don't want to volunteer. I say, well, you have to volunteer. Well, but then it's compulsory. No, it's voluntary. And the reason that they want it to be voluntary is because if it was illegal, right, you can lie on your tax return. You can do whatever you wanted on it, and they couldn't use it against you because of the Fifth Amendment. But also, there's all sorts of violations of the Constitution in the income tax. I'm just trying to I forgot that I had this program up, and I'm getting phone calls. I have a do not disturb. Yeah, so there's all sorts of ways that a compulsory income tax would violate the law. The income tax is based on self-assessment. You're supposed to assess yourself, and if you don't do that, there's no legal authority for the government to do it. So there's a lot of legal arguments.
Sure, they get you to waive your Fourth and Fifth Amendment on its face.
Yeah, and of course, the taxing provisions of the Constitution that were not changed by the 16th Amendment, Congress, if they want to level a direct tax on income, they still have to apportion it. The 16th Amendment didn't change that. The 16th Amendment just said, well, if you don't want to apportion the income tax, then you have to levy it as an excise tax. But the government's not doing that. I mean, the government is violating numerous Supreme Court decisions in the way it it enforces the income tax. And, you know, my father just tries to point all these things out. But of course, you know, the courts are routinely rubber stamping government action that violates the Constitution. I mean, there's really, you know, as far as the government is concerned, there's nothing, or rather, as far as the courts are concerned, there's nothing that the government can't do. The government is in no way inhibited or restrained by the Constitution. The government has unlimited power. And, you know, that's one of the things that my father still never really understood or accepted, because even though he's been in jail for 10 years, he continues to fight, thinking that he's going to get out, thinking he's going to get justice in a justice system that has no justice. And, you know, which gets me to the news that we want to talk about, is that my father, who is 87 and who has been in jail for 10 years, was just diagnosed with terminal lung cancer. And, you know, initially he told me the prison doctor said he had maybe 4 to 6 months to live. But then I'm not really sure. I tried to talk. He may have longer than that. I don't know. Maybe he has a year. It's hard to say. You know, they did have a cancer specialist that talked to him. But, you know, he's still in jail and he still has another year and a half or two to go. And so in theory, he won't survive the rest of his sentence. And so he would have an amounts to a life sentence for a nonviolent tax crime. And, you know, but we are still trying to get him out on a compassionate release. The crazy part about it is my father doesn't even want to get out yet on compassionate release. He still wants to get out on the merits of his legal arguments. But I think we've been able to persuade him to allow the compassionate release process. But, you know, who knows how long this thing is going to take? The whole prison system is so inefficient.
Well, it's very saddening to me because I probably had dinner with your dad when he would come to Austin to give speeches. And in a few events I spoke at in Dallas and once in Vegas, probably had dinner with him 10 times. And man, the stories he tells, and he is like a real Archie Bunker type guy, real Americana. And it's so sad to hear all the persecution he's gone through. But they hated his guts because he was traveling the whole U.S. speaking to crowds of thousands. He was on the radio. He was selling books by the tens of thousands a month. I mean, he was really giving them a problem, and they threw his butt in jail, and now I guess they hope to see him die there.
Yeah, I mean, they wanted to make an example of him. They wanted people to, hey, don't fight the IRS or you'll end up like Irwin Schiff, right? You'll end up in jail. And that's the whole purpose of a political prisoner. You're trying to send a message. I mean, clearly, my father is not a criminal. The most you can say about my father is that he's mistaken, but we don't put people in jail for having good faith beliefs that turn out to be wrong.
But he's clearly right, though.
Yeah, well, you know, I think he's right about a lot of things. But I know there's nobody can argue that my father is insincere, that he's some kind of con man, that he doesn't believe what he says. Of course he believes what he says. There's no doubt about it.
Well, remember, the judge said, do not publish the book anymore. You can walk away right now. He could have put another book out. He said no and started putting the book back out.
Yeah, well, they actually banned him from selling his book. And I think it's the only time that's happened since Lolita. But they didn't ban the book itself.
And, of course, the book is the federal mafia.
Yeah. They just banned my father from selling it. But, you know, here's another interesting angle to talk about, you know, because when I talked to his caseworker, because I'm trying to get him released into my care, and one of the things would happen is if he ends up getting out of jail and able to live with my house, I have to make sure that I get rid of all my guns, that I'm not allowed to have any guns in the house if you have an ex-felon, which is so ridiculous that I have to surrender my Second Amendment rights in order to care for my sick father. I mean, the reality of it is my father is practically blind. You know, and all my guns are locked up in safes. Even if I gave my father the combinations, he still couldn't open them. You know, and I don't even think he could load the gun, let alone shoot it. And yet, just because he's a tax offender, he can't be in the house if anybody has a firearm for self-defense. So I have to disarm myself in order to take care of my father. I mean, that's just another, you know, violation of, you know, the Second Amendment. But, everything the government does violates their constitutional rights. So, you know, why should they stop there?
Well, he's in the federal prison there in Dallas. Folks need to contact the Federal Bureau of Prisons and just say, release the political prisoner, Irwin Schiff. And I would do it nicely, but I would say, look, he's got terminal lung cancer. Normally, they release nonviolent, quote, offenders when they have something terminal because it's a drain on the system. This is ridiculous. He's been in there 10 years for selling a book that says the IRS is a fraud. That's like going to jail for saying Hillary Clinton's a witch. I mean, it's just a prima facie fact. And now with all this IRS news of them persecuting everyone, it just really is a cherry on top of how evil this government is. Who are these people? Man, I would feel like, I mean, I feel like if I do something bad, it's going to come back on me. I wasn't taught that. I just feel that. I can't screw over good people. And I wonder how the government, I wonder how that judge sits around knowing that they put some guy in jail for 10 plus years and he may die there for putting out a book. I mean, it's just ridiculous.
Well, I mean, obviously it's more than just the book. I mean, that they're going to say, well, you know, he was advocating non-payment of taxes. He was helping people. What my father was trying to do was educate people as he understood the law, and he encouraged people to make their own decisions. And I always remember when my dad gave seminars, he would always encourage lawyers and accountants to show up. If he ever talked to somebody about not paying taxes, he would say, look, bring your accountant, bring your lawyer.
He would always say that on my show. He'd go, I'm not telling you to do this. It's what I do. But here's the facts.
Yeah. And, you know, I've sat around many people who have admitted to me, you know, I've seen the, you know, where lawyers and have said, look, you know, your dad is technically right. He's legally right, but the government won't let him get away with it. I mean, that's an important thing when people, lawyers, I've talked to judges who have told me that. Okay, yes, technically your dad may be right, but it doesn't matter. Well, shouldn't the law matter? Are we a nation of law or are we a nation
of... Well, here's the bottom line. Your dad's the kind of guy that made America great. He's willing to go to jail and stay there and won't recant for the truth. I mean, that's what we're missing in this country. If more people were like your dad, we wouldn't have to go to jail for the truth because we wouldn't allow this to happen.
Yeah, you know, he's very rare in that sense. Look, I don't do it. I mean, I pay taxes. I pay a lot of taxes. And you know, not because I believe I'm legally required to do it.
But they're the mafia. They'll break your legs.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you know, I'm like the store owner that pays the protection money because I don't want to stand up to the mob. Well, my dad stood up to the mob, and, you know, he's been in jail for 10 years. And, you know, that's the spirit that made this country. I mean, look at our founding fathers. I mean, how easy would it have been for George Washington, a very wealthy guy, and all the other framers? I mean, they didn't have to stand up to King George. They didn't have to stand up to those principles. They had good lives, and they risked it all for a concept, for freedom, for an idea, right? And most Americans, you know, weren't even involved in that. But can you imagine today? I mean, would we have had any kind of revolution if the type of Americans who are around today were around, you know, in 1776, if America, you know, we'd still be ruled by the king, by England. But, you know, who knows? We might even be better off, you know, because the British did a pretty good job with Hong Kong. So maybe they would have done a good job with us if we had stayed under the crown. But, you know, what Americans are willing to accept today, the type of taxation, the type of regulation is off the charts compared to the tiny little bit of government that Americans were protesting from King George, right?
You're absolutely right. Peter Schiff's our guest, Europac.com. We're going to get the specifics up in the next day or so. I'll probably launch it Monday because Friday's a bad day to do it. We're going to take the video from this live radio TV show, put out a call to arms politically Monday with an article, with the addresses for folks to just say, have some basic decency and, you know, let this guy out. They let the average murderer out of state prison within 4 years, federal within 10. Those are national numbers. Your dad's been in over 10 years for his political speech. And do they really want to make him a martyr where he dies? I mean, it'd be better for him to get out, see his grandkids, spend some time with you. Right, Peter?
Well, absolutely. And the thing with the government, they don't care if they let a murderer out. Because what's the worst thing he can do? Murder some people? They don't care about that. But a tax protester, that really scares them. Because he gets out, he educates people. He shines a spotlight on the illegal actions of government. And the government is afraid of that. The government wants to keep my father in jail to keep him quiet. Right?
That's right. And let's be fair. He said he's not going to shut up. I mean, he stands by what he stands by.
Yeah. I mean, look, he's still there in jail fighting this fight. You know, he still hasn't willing to concede that he's lost, even though he spent the last 10 years of his life in jail. And, you know, ultimately, in the long run, he has his books out there. I think he'll be vindicated, you know, in the things that he stood up for. But it might not be in his lifetime, but it may be maybe in my children's lifetime.
Well, America, freedom to fascism really scared him, too. Aaron Russo. There's so many. Congressman Hansen fought the IRS. They put him in jail and tortured him. I mean, folks, let me tell you, these are real heroes for this republic that have stood up against this organization. They come after you. They try to take everything Aaron Russo had when he put that film out, and he suddenly died of cancer. I mean, they mean business, and it is so dangerous. We didn't have time to get to calls today. We got a final segment. I want you to get into the economy when we come back. Peter Schiff, Europac.com. Stay with us. We're going to go to break here in just a moment. And this is what I keep trying to hammer home to people. I've sat here and watched them kill and set up and destroy hundreds of people. And they've tried a lot of dirty tricks on us and had me beat up in a parking lot and told me to shut up. And I mean, this is real. Now, we've gotten so effective and so big that whatever calculation they've made, they've left us alone at this point. In about the last year, man, they tried a lot of dirty tricks behind the scenes I'm not going to even get into, but it was like a movie. Do not take talk radio for granted. Do not take libertarian ideas for granted. There's a big Examiner article. Drudge, Fox News could be censored under new federal rules, expert warns. I've seen 10 different members of the administration call for the fairness doctrine to be brought back. They're trying to arrest Joe Arpaio, and they're suing him right now. I mean, just understand, they're coming after us because they're in trouble. That's why. Pray for us. Financially support us. Go to InfoWarsLife.com. We've got Brain Force that's got a lot of just healthy, good compounds that optimize your brain activity. You've heard the rave reviews. It's amazing. InfoWarsLife.com, your purchase of InfoWarsLife.com products, funds or operations, Supermale Vitality. Go read the over 500 reviews just for Supermale and Superfemale Vitality. Known concentrated herbs that are known to boost vitality, energy, libido. Try it. And then I know you'll be a repeat customer because the formulas are the Rolls Royce for a very low price. InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. Become an InfoWars Nightly News subscriber. See all my films. $5.95 a month. 20 people can use each membership. So we have our own platform when they censor us. I want to thank all the members of PrisonPlanet.tv and the Nightly News as well. But Supermale Vitality, X2 and Brain Force is all back in stock. We got plenty of the Supermale Vitality right now. Brain Force will sell out by Monday. Try it for yourself. Experience it. We'll be back. I'm Alex Jones. Welcome back. Alex Jones here. Infowars.com. Up on screen, a small business person has Uncle Sam as a partner. Again, a small business person has Uncle Sam as a partner who puts up no money, does no work, and wants 30 or 40%, and will throw you in prison for saying that. And again, they want to intimidate and shut everybody up, but I'm telling you, it's going too far. All right, we got about 6 minutes left in this segment. I'm going to cover news, clips, special reports, and your phone calls next hour. And what would war with Russia be like? The Pentagon's been wargaming it. Jeb Bush is back out promoting torture for the very groups the West is funding. Just absolutely ridiculous. But finishing up with our guest from Europac.com, Peter Schiff. Peter, getting back into China, the economy, what's happening. I mean, do you think it's going to degenerate quicker, as a lot of people are saying, or you're saying it's next year? What's the next shoe to drop for you that you're watching?
Again, the only shoe, I think, is going to be the realization that the Fed is not finished with quantitative easing and that the U.S. recovery isn't real, that we're back in recession. In fact, all of the economic problems that created the Great Recession still exist. In fact, they've been exacerbated by the very cure that the Fed chose to try to heal us, right? The cheap money, quantitative easing, 0% interest rates. It was the Fed's manipulation of money supply and interest rates that inflated the bubbles. You know, sure, they had help from Congress, but I think the chief enabler is the Federal Reserve, and they've done a lot of damage. And I think when people come to terms with this reality, it's going to be a huge game changer. I think the bottom is going to drop out of the dollar in a very big way. I think you're going to see a spectacular reversal in gold prices, silver prices, commodity prices. When people realize that, you know, we are just going to print and print and print. The Fed is just getting started. The helicopters are still in the hangars. They're getting warmed up. This is going to be more, you know, more money printing. And this is not going to end well. This is not the happy picture, the smiley face that Janet Yellen is putting on this, or all the Wall Street economists. And there's not a lot of time. You know, people have been riding this bubble on the dollar. The U.S. stock market made new highs. People need to act now. You know, people need to open up accounts, you know, and with me at Euro Pacific's Capital so that they can get their money out of U.S. assets, get out of Dodge before the bullets start flying. You got to get into foreign stocks and the right stocks. I mean, there are certain countries, Switzerland, Singapore, New Zealand, I mean, Hong Kong, there are places that you should invest to escape the carnage. And you got to get out of U.S. currency. You got to pick the best foreign currencies. You got to own real money. You got to own gold and silver. You got to look at the opportunity in the mining shares that have been beaten down because people have no idea what's going on. The people who have been selling gold stocks, these are the same guys buying the subprime mortgages.
Well, the elites are hoarding and buying gold. That's admitted. And gold's gone back up a little bit. I just don't see, there's got to be in an inflationary system, even if we're in a depression, gold's got to go up. We know in the Great Depression, towards the end, it did go way back up.
Yeah, look, again, people have confidence in the central bankers. They have confidence in Yellen, just the way they had confidence in Alan Greenspan in the 1990s. And that was a disaster. That was false confidence. And it's the same people that have bought into the same, you know, monetary magic. They've been fooled again by the sleight of hand of the Fed. And they have no idea what's right around the corner. If they were surprised by the financial crisis, they ain't seen nothing yet, because this next crisis is going to be much worse, but it's also going to be much different. Because it's not going to be a credit crisis. It's going to be a currency crisis. It's going to be a crisis in the U.S. dollar, right? You don't have to worry about the yuan going down. It's the dollar going down. We are going to win this currency war, which means every American who is not prepared will lose.
And they just hope those dollars don't come back and they can hide it and maybe lower oil prices to cover that. But it's certainly a balancing act. We've all got front row seats to it. Peter Schiff, thanks for joining us. We'll talk to you again, hopefully, in a few weeks.
Thanks, Alex. Have a good weekend.
You bet. You too. And tell your dad when you talk to him, the cavalry's coming. We're going to try to put some pressure on next week. And obviously, you can work with us on that. Coming up, we're going to play the video of what Jesse Ventura, who's coming on later next week, has to say about Donald Trump. He says it's shaking the system to its core. That's Paul Watson's latest article up on Infowars.com. Experts, weeks till global collapse. We've got that breakdown video from yesterday's interview with Mr. Dent up on Infowars.com. You know, I tend to listen to Schiff's analysis on inflation, and I see evidence of it, but I also see some things being deflated. And I don't know who's more right, him or Dent, but I tell you, any way you look at it from any angle, and believe me, I'm not wanting this. I just know we're sitting on top of the biggest bubble the world has ever seen. Real estate, currencies, debt, derivatives. And elites are building armored redoubts and gearing up for martial law, and there's huge military actions taking place. Is it all for naught? And in many areas of the world are in depression. I want to talk about this subject with listeners. You can call in about anything you want, but I'd like you to also give me your take on, do you think the global collapse is coming? What do you think it's going to look like? It's already really bad in a lot of parts of the world. Or just can this keep rolling on forever? What do you think all the preparations are for? Classified. Pentagon exercise revealed U.S. would struggle to win war with Russia. It would take everything we had. Paul Joseph Watson article, Infowars.com. The Pentagon has been running a series of exercises throughout the summer based on the hypothetical ground war with Russia, which reveals the U.S. would struggle to defeat Moscow. Their Navy's not good, but they got missiles, they got tanks, and they got nukes. Two defense officials who refused to be named today told the Daily Beast that Washington is not ready for a sustained conflict. Could we probably beat the Russians today in a sustained battle? Sure. But it would take everything we had, one official said. What we are saying is that we are not ready as we want to be. But if nuclear weapons get used, none of it matters, and there's a good chance they would. So stop looking at having this war. Stop trying to topple the Russian government. If our government had the moral high ground and wasn't a bunch of criminals, I would still say if the Russians aren't invading other countries, aren't trying to take over, don't mess with them. You just, as common sense historically, that's criminal. But we have a disgusting government trying to turn the Middle East over to Al-Qaeda and the Saudi Arabians. So there's just no moral high ground anywhere here. The wars in Iraq and Afghanistan have depleted the U.S. Army's ability to maintain a sufficient troop presence. the exercises revealed. There would also be little time to sufficiently train airmen for the conflict. Against an adversary like Russia, this is a quote, we can't take the kind of air dominance we've had in conflict since 9/11 for granted. Yeah, you're not even in a position like you were in Iraq or Afghanistan. This is the Russians. And yes, they have a rotting Navy. And let's bring Joe Jennings in if he's there at his desk, because he brought up the fact, why don't we just have Putin and Obama get in a boxing ring and fight like they did in old times, our two champions, instead of us having nuclear war and killing the planet. You want to add anything else, Joe?
Yeah, I think that it solved two problems. You know, that's a race war. We could solve the race war problem right there.
I guess you could say the Russians are behind the African slave trade.
Sure.
I mean, Putin is white. It's his fault.
It's his fault.
Who do you think would win in a fight between Obama and Putin?
Oh, come on. Obama's a smoker. Putin's bear, Russian bear.
Really? I'd love to see that fight. I don't know. I mean, Obama grew up in Chicago. He's probably pretty tough.
He'd probably poke him in the eye.
I think he could take out the KGB agent. You know.
I don't know.
Old Pooty Poot. No. Pooty Poot does jiu-jitsu all day and martial arts. I think he would probably dispatch old Obozo pretty quick. But they're both puppets at the end of the day. Another amazing classic from the great director. You know, speaking of Escape from New York, since you guys came in with this intro, that ties in. Let's pull up in a minute the trailer. You can find it on YouTube from Escape from New York. This that came out in the early 1980s, where you got a shadow government, black helicopters. New York's been turned into a giant prison colony, which is something the French and others have done with islands before. And the president gets brought down by a terrorist in the middle of New York City. If you haven't seen the John Carpenter classic, and they put exploding microchips in the arteries of Snake Plissken, a special ops guy, and send him in. We were just talking about having Obama and Putin in a ring, give them both baseball bats with nails in them, instead of, you know, us having nuclear war. How about they get in a ring? I mean, back in the old days when they'd have wars in Spain between the different Christians, they wouldn't have wars most of the time between one city-state and another. They would just have their champions fight. And back then, it was usually the king or his son. Like, you didn't get to be a king 1,000 years ago in Spain or in England unless you didn't lead the troops. And see, I can see back then you admired the king because he'd be like your war champion, you know, the toughest, smartest guy around. Nowadays, we have these globalist slime bags, you know, that get advice from Gruber about how to lie to everybody. Oh, what great leaders you are. So I'm told we already have it. That was quick. Good job. So why not, before I go to your phone calls, play the trailer for Escape from New York? I think this is the answer. How about Escape from the New World Order? And then we're going to cover the news I haven't hit. I've already mentioned some of it. And take your phone calls on the world financial collapse that I think is pretty clear is starting to unravel. Is it this fall, this winter, next year? I don't know, but it's getting closer, and the elites are bunkering and digging in. What do you think's going on? 800. It's a free-for-all. Everybody can call in. 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. Your calls are coming up in the next segment. But without further ado, Escape from New York. I think I'm going to watch that tonight.
Escape from New York. The greatest escape of them all is about to blow the future apart.
Escape from L.A. is horrible. She needs L.A. to fall off in the ocean. Of course, that's not funny. It might actually do it. It culturally has already fallen off in the ocean. 800-259-9231. Here's the deal. As stuff unravels, which the elite is orchestrating, as they want a post-industrial world, as they kill NASA, kill developments, kill technological developments that they don't control, I'm going to be in the rear with the gear out in the countryside. I'm doing my best to try to stop all this from unfolding, but there is no enemy to even attack in a civil war. They're going to try to brand it as if you go shoot cops or shoot the military, you're winning. That's the plan, is to chew up the police and military during a martial law crackdown to then, after a year of the lights being off or more, bringing in the UN forces. And that's not out of movies, folks. That's out of the admissions. In fact, I ought to pull all that up. I've talked about it. We got the documents and actually show that. Because I've seen it in the Washington Post where, like, during emergencies, they will bring in foreign troops to stabilize the United States. You want to know how they're going to handle states that rebel? Governors that don't go along with stuff, they're just going to turn the power off. Because all the microchips in these power plants and these grids, the globalists have the codes to. You see, that's what smart growth is. That's what the smart cities are, the smart trans, the smart appliances. Is all maximum overdrive for real. But it's not Skynet being run by machines, as I always said. It's Skynet run by the humans, using the machines against the rest of the humans, which in the last Terminator, not the latest one, I haven't seen that, but the last one that actually got produced by guys hooked in with the Bilderberg Group, I'll just leave it at that. It's a human brain at the core of Skynet running the operation. And that's basically what we're dealing with here in their freaked out minds. You're like, why would they want to do that? Because they believe that's how they're going to live forever. And before you think, oh, that's fantastical, that's not going to happen, remember, biometrics was invented in the 1850s, eugenics, all of it, by a British Royal Commission that funded a bunch of scientists to come up with a plan for social control for the Transylvanian royalty that rules Britannia. Now, that's more freaked out than a movie, isn't it? Vlad the Impaler's great, 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 great grandchildren. I think it's like 20 generations down over that 1,000 years or so. To these people, and then their plan has actually worked, and they've now got almost planetary government and think they're going to merge with machines. And who knows, the machines might double-cross them. I mean, it's so dangerous. It's like the astronaut said we had on a few days ago. We're in a little bitty blue lifeboat with 20,000 nuclear weapons, more like 40,000, but he said 20. I guess he means operable. This is crazy town. But then the globalists created all of this, proliferated the weapons, and then want world government, or they're going to detonate them. Give them the power, give them world government, give them control, or they'll have nuclear war. And they've used our tax money to build the bunkers. You know what? Let's just go to calls now, and then I'll get to the news after that. I've already covered a lot of it, but there's some good news, some bad news, some crazy news, some insane news. Healthcare.gov is giving illegal aliens the free healthcare. Nobody else gets it. But if they don't verify social security numbers, citizenship status, none of it. I'm sorry. I shouldn't laugh at all this. It's just so ridiculous. Let's go ahead and go to your phone calls. Robert in Tennessee, you're on the air. Thanks for calling in today. Yeah, I'm having a trouble on your phone. It may not be connected. Go ahead and try again. I'm going to have to put that caller on hold. We may have a failure on his phone or a failure at the network. We'll put you on hold. Let's go to Andy in Tennessee. Andy, you're on the air.
Hey, Alex, how you doing?
Good. Go ahead.
Hey, listen. A couple weeks ago, you were talking about a thing. I think of it as a movement called What's Your Cause? And this really struck me because as I listen to the show, there's such a plethora of topics and issues that we're dealing with. And I hear you when callers call and they talk about, you know, they praise you and you're not into that. And I get that. But, you know, we do all have the power. The problem is that with all of this inundation of trouble, it's hard to nail down what exactly our cause is. And when we're able to figure that out, how to pursue that cause and rise up in that cause.
No, I hear you. So I'll let you continue, but let me just throw this out. I highlight the solutions, in my view. Get rid of Boehner. Put a patriot in the speakership. Expose the private Federal Reserve. Abolish the IRS. Get us out of the United Nations. Stop starting wars with foreign countries. Stop funding radical Islamicists. Control our border. Stop advertising free welfare to all of the unskilled workers of the world. You go down the line and say no to the globalist agenda. You cut off the blood supply to the New World Order.
Absolutely. But this is the thing, though, is with all of these topics, any one of us can latch on to one and then reach out to other people who have taken that on as their cause and then grow that cause to be a force within this battle against the globalists. But it's difficult to do that because it's hard to say where to start. And if there were a place, and I used your YouTube site as an example. On your YouTube channel, you have it broken down by topic, basically. And if we were able to have a clearinghouse where we can explore each thing and then find the one that really targets us, that really is on our...
Sure, I agree. We should have a specific video on the Federal Reserve, a specific video on genetic engineering, and a specific video... I mean, that's all great ideas. I'm going to come back and let you finish your point on solutions. Then we'll go to Frank, Gerald, Carl, Frank, and others. We're taking your phone calls in this third hour. Andy in Tennessee, specifically, what is it you think we can do better? Because there's 100 things, 1,000 things I could do better. InfoWars, though, is not the rise and fall of the liberty movement worldwide. That is in individual hearts and minds everywhere. We're just a focal point, breaking down history, trying to mobilize others to take action in their area. And then there's no way that the bad actors can stop us. That's why they want us decadent, dumbed down, not believing we have power. But you specifically, have some ideas. Go ahead.
Well, thanks for bearing with me. But I'm thinking in terms of, maybe even just on your website, to keep it simple on your end, if you had links that could direct people to movements that were specifically involved in... say international finance or the pro-life movement or what have you. And then it's out of your hands. It goes to the people, the people.
No,
who
I hear you. I got to jump, Andy. We have the links up to the group putting out the videos exposing Planned Parenthood. Anybody could just follow the video and link to them. We have the pro-life groups on and plug their websites. We actually spoon feed all this. When you get down into local groups, I can't specifically say go to this group or that group because I don't have the human intelligence to say what's a group, what's a bad group. That's for you to suss out or for you to start as your own organization. But I hear you. We could do better. We'll try. Frank in New York, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hey, Alex, how are you?
Good, brother. Go ahead.
Very good. Thank you. Oh, just to let you know, basically, you're my Morpheus. You actually woke me up to everything that's going on. And everything that I know today, all the knowledge that have occurred, that I've actually known, is because of you. And I just want to say that. And I consider you part of my family every day.
Well, I'm honored. I'm honored, sir, and it's a humbling job. But I'm just an average person who woke up to this earlier than you did. We were all in the Matrix at one time. And so I'm very honored, sir. Thank you.
Okay. My question is this. From the Pope, from our world leaders, from our bankers, from all the people that are causing all these travesties around the world, basically they want their Messiah, which is the devil, to come up and appear, basically. I don't want to sound religiously. I'm a Catholic. I don't trust the Pope. I think the Pope's a phony, in my opinion. I just want to just tell those people out there that are non-believers, they're first-time listeners to you, that you should start waking up, tell your friends and family what's going on. Even though they probably laugh at you, but unfortunately, one day they're not going to be laughing at you because everything's going to turn out to be true. Hopefully, that's not the case, but the way things are going right now, it's happening.
Well, sure. Christ told us, look out for wolves in sheep's clothing. And again, I wouldn't criticize the Catholic Church before because for all its problems, I saw mainstream media attacking it, which is a sign that they didn't like it. Well, that's because they were taking it over. You could say whatever you wanted about different periods of the Catholic Church. Now it's promoting socialism and communism, not fighting abortion, pushing world government, carbon taxes. I mean, Pope Francis is the most powerful globalist leader promoting the New World Order other than Obama right now. And it's just sickening. I mean, I watched like an hour-long video last night that was on Infowars.com of an upset Catholic, you know, saying I want my church back out in L.A. at an event, but I didn't really watch him so much. He was like two-thirds of the way in, and the media acted like it was outrageous that he stood up and started yelling. It was like a communist meeting with them just organizing all the Catholics. But listen, I've got family that are Methodist, and I've gone to their Methodist church 15 years ago and 5 years ago and a year ago. Now you go there, they got a husband and wife team up there. They got rid of the old preacher who was anti-war and a pretty good classical liberal. They've got people in there, and I mean, it is like hearing a Fidel Castro speech or something. But then they mix into it a bunch of eugenics and Planned Parenthood and Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. I mean, it's the churches are Democratic Party run, and they can be political as they want. They're left alone. If a conservative church says we shouldn't kill babies, the IRS comes after them. So there's a reign of intimidation and terror in this country. So I'm not just picking on the Catholic Church, but to have a pope behaving and acting like this, you know, we're entering the final phase. This is a big deal. Go ahead.
I work with all these trendies at work and all these college students and all that stuff. And they I'm telling you, they're so brainwashed. I tell them what's going on. They think they're so cool. They think that they're part, you know, they think because they're educated, they're part of the establishment. I guess that sounds crazy that you're saying that. But basically, these people are very damn ignorant, and it's just so damn frustrating. You tell them about eugenics. You tell them.
Oh, yeah. All they have is their cult. They don't have a future. They don't have a job. They don't have health. But they have the cult that they're part of the intellectual team. And then we go out and interview them, and they want to put gun owners in forced labor camps. They are a cult of sniveling, dangerous, shallow, vapid scum. And I'll say it, they're a danger, a clear and present danger. Drudge, Fox News could be censored under new federal rules, expert warns. I'm going to get to the news. I'm going to take a few calls, go into news, and back to your calls. Major breaking news is about to go up on Infowars.com. They're going to bring the story in here in a moment. It just went up. I'll be telling you about that as well. And I'll be back this Sunday, Lord willing. I don't take anything for granted, 4 to 6 p.m. Central Standard Time. And here is the new video. Spokane County, they've done it again. Sheriff compares constitutionalist. Remember they said last year they need the armored vehicles for the American people? Mikhail Thelen wrote this article. I believe this is the type of story that should go viral. Doesn't mean Drudge should link to it. I just call it Drudge-worthy. We'll get it up on our Facebook and Twitter. Sheriff compares constitutionalists to ISIS. There are some of these folks that want to overthrow the government, period. This is how ISIS starts. So he's compared, and we're going to have that video. They're grabbing it right now, and we're going to be playing that here for you on air. Right now, let's go to some more of your phone calls. And we will be going over that as soon as we're able to grab the video. But that just broke. Mikhail Thelen, Infowars.com. And then let's grab the Spokane video from last year where the SWAT team commander goes, we need this armored vehicle. There are a lot of gun owners and veterans and constitutionalists. And we've got them in Indiana saying the same thing. Constitutionalists haven't done anything to anybody. I mean, maybe three cops a year. On average, I think four got killed in 2013, three in 2014, and I think two cops so far have been killed by constitutionalists where the media could link it to a group, sovereign citizens. I mean, that's one of the lowest crime rates of any group out there. But if you watch MSNBC, you'd believe there is just an epidemic of police being killed by right-wingers. And it's total baloney. But they keep saying it's going to happen. And a lot of it is then it gets the police in this attitude of messing with constitutionalists, and then you get a self-fulfilling prophecy. Wow. So as soon as we get that video, we'll be playing it. The video is up on Infowars.com. Shock video, police prepare for war with gun owners and preppers. So they've now doubled down on it again. In fact, I'm in the article and in the announcement. In an article featured in the August 2015 edition of The Inlander, the Washington State Sheriff draws comparison to ISIS terror group while railing against everyone from InfoWars, Alex Jones, to Washington State Representative Matthew Shea. Yeah, we've got the photo of like six Washington State reps wearing. Will you guys bring me one? I wear it on one of my jackets. One of the Made in 1776 pins. Because really, anybody can wear an American flag. We need folks to start wearing 1776 lapels or little Paul Revere pelt. And the cover is him standing on a map. Let's show that again for TV viewers. Of Don't Tread on Me people. Standing on the snake. Spokane is one of the most patriotic anti-New World Order awake areas. In fact, that's it. I'm going to speak with George Norrie in a week in Toronto, but I'm going to Spokane. That's it. This sheriff has done it. I'm going to pick a date today, and I always get busy. I'm going to pick a date in like the next month or so to go to Spokane and to broadcast live from there, and I'm going to go to the sheriff's department nicely, and I'm going to ask for an interview with his lordship, and I'm going to say, man, knock it off. I don't know who's running you, who's in control of you, but you know they're trying to start a civil war with the Patriots. And by the way, they're not just right-wingers in Spokane. They're like libertarians that know what's going on. They're super awake. It's one of the most conservative cities in the country, in an island of just brainwashed libtards is the word. I call them tyranny tards because they're not liberal. There are some of these folks that want to overthrow the government. No, the government was overthrown by foreign globalists. We want the government back. They want to hit a reset button, the sheriff said. If they're willing to lie to get that reset button, this is how ISIS starts. Lie. Oh, I'm a liar now. The Inlander piece highlights the sheriff's ongoing campaign against local conservative groups who he feels are pushing dangerous rhetoric. When asked to specifically name those responsible, he named both Representative Shea and all those folks who created the video about the deputy. The deputy, yeah, he says it's a lie. The deputy says constitutionalists are why they have armored vehicles. And we have that video. Here is that video.
The nice thing about this piece of equipment is that if somebody is directing fire toward a team that's trying to get in, they safely can, they can pull right up to a front. Take enemy fire and still try to address a threat without being fear of getting shot.
So I'm thinking that is totally appropriate in Iraq, but where, what kind of a situation in the U.S. would you see that happening?
I mean, we've got a lot of constitutionalists, a lot of people that, that stockpile weapons, a lot of ammunition. I mean, we've got a lot of constitutionalists, a lot of people that, that stockpile weapons, a lot of ammunition. They have weapons here locally.
Oh my gosh. And by the way, then the sheriff said it was edited, so they put out the full five-minute interview, and he said even more worse stuff. It's like the Planned Parenthood thing. I mean, we have police departments and sheriff's departments from New York to Indiana to Washington State to Colorado to Florida making the exact same statements. This is amazing. So this news is up on Infowars.com. Artist rendition of the sheriff standing on a Don't Tread on Me flag in August issue that just came out. In fact, we can click to enlarge that and put that on screen for TV viewers. Infowars.com. Radio listeners, just go to Infowars.com or PrisonPlanet.com. I want that red linked. I mean, what is wrong with this sheriff? He can't be that stupid. To fall into George Soros' hands, they've spent countless billions in the last few decades to get a civil war going between the gun owners and the police. I mean, number one, that's traitorous. Number two, most of the cops they know are conservative or libertarian. As bad as some of the police are, folks, they're more awake than the general public. I mean, it's a fact. They're not our enemy. We need to reform the police from the feds, who themselves are captured. And so you got these little stars. The Southern Poverty Law Center, which he admits he's advised by in the ADL. Criminal organizations, in my view, anti-American organizations, clearly. I mean, the ADL's lost lawsuits. They've been caught breaking into police departments to steal intelligence files in San Francisco. They are so creepy. And that's the ADL. And I just don't know what to say anymore that he would be dumb enough to be part of this whole movement to start a fight with the liberty movement. And the globalists are very close to staging terror attacks and blaming it on us. That's very clear. And this is their ace in the hole. That's why they keep saying, I want to kill cops. I support the Boston bombing, blah, blah, blah. Just out of the blue, the Oath Keepers are there threatening people with guns, and they work for us. They're not threatening anybody, and they don't work for us either, but we support what they're doing. All these misrepresentations, because I'll get up here and have an investigative journalist on about Jeb Bush connected to narcotics trafficking or Hillary Clinton connected to third world dictators. And yeah, I'm aggressive about it because if I'm going to risk my life, I mean, I'm angry. I'm going in. This is real, people. It's not a game having the Pope call for world government. It's not a game, all the different things they're doing to us. Fluoride in the water on record is to brain damage us and lower our fertility. That enough is reason for revolution, but it's not revolution. Criminals, eugenicists, hijack the country. The window into it all is the baby parts. A month ago, they were saying that was fake video. Then they said it was edited. Then they said it wasn't true. Now they are defending the sales. It's a lot worse than the baby parts. And yeah, I'm angry about it. But as a man, at a genetic, cellular, spiritual level, I'm like the Tasmanian devil, man. I am ready to fight. And I understand 90% of war is physical, so I am savagely attacking them with the truth. And notice this sheriff says we're liars. I remember the articles we wrote about last year when all this broke. And his video press release where he says InfoWars are liars. Buddy, I'm a liar. Like I'm a Chinese jet pilot from Pluto. I mean, my problem is I can't control myself and I tell the truth. Sometimes when I should just keep my mouth shut. I crave the truth. I live the truth. I want to be the truth. I mean, I'm so truthful that when, you know, girlfriends and stuff would ask me, does this dress look good? I'd tell you no. Or does this zit on the end of my nose look bad? Yeah, it looks bad. So what? All I got's my integrity. That's why they always attack it, because they got my phones tapped, my computers tapped. They know all about me going back to high school. They know how real I am, how I went up against drug dealing cops when I was 16 years old, 15 years old. They know I've always been involved. I've been involved fighting tyranny since I was 14 years old, before I even knew I was doing it. I'm at a party with my buddy's older brother. His older brother's getting drugs for cheerleaders. I notice it's a guy in a uniform driving off in the Corvette. I say to his brother, was that a cop just sold you that pot and that ecstasy? I wasn't smoking the pot or taking the ecstasy. It was for the cheerleaders. And he said, yeah, keep your mouth shut. I think I was like 12 or 13 then. By the time I was 14, I'd see cops that I knew were dealing drugs, and I'd be like, they'd pull over me and my buddy who was older driving with a six-pack of beer under the seat, and they'd go, I'm going to take you to jail for this. And I'd say, I saw you deal drugs a few years ago. And the cop would just freak out and start hyperventilating and say, you want me to kill you, kid? And I said, man, I don't know what you're doing, but you're not going to take me to jail for beer when you're a drug dealer. 14 years old. I understood that stuff. And Texas Monthly didn't believe me, so they went and investigated in Rockwall and found out the sheriff went to prison for cocaine importation and that the police department had been implicated in drug rings. Hell, they ran the prostitutes, they ran the drugs, all of it. And I wasn't involved in it. I lived in a wealthy golf course, upper middle class neighborhood. And I mean, I just saw it for myself. And I'm not talking about me anymore. It's not about Alex Jones. It's that I had these experiences, and I'm not going to be signed on to it, aborting babies. Because if I go along with it, I'm involved in it. I'm not going to go along with DynCorp grabbing five-year-olds and putting them on slave trains. I'm not going to be involved in it. And let me tell you, if I don't fight it, I'm involved in it. I mean, I feel guilty that I'm not doing enough to fight it. When I cover this stuff, I feel like I've done it. That's what I call God-fearing. I mean, to explain how this feels, I feel guilty for all this stuff. I mean, I've seen like white thugs, black thugs, Hispanic thugs, you name it, repeatedly in stores in my life or at a gas station, smart off to some old man or some old lady. And I probably shouldn't do it. And now that I have kids, I don't. I got, you know, something else in the car to defend. And I'll just say, hey, listen, start a fight with somebody you think you can. They'll start blowing up. I'll go, line up. I'm going to beat your ass right now, you sons of bitches. And I'm sorry to have to talk like that, but that's true. And you know what it is? I know at those points I could wipe the floor with all those people. And it's not because I'm the toughest guy around. It's instinctive that I don't like punks and thugs running wild and running roughshod on people. That's a normal male response. You want to shoot your mouth off to an old lady? Why don't you say it to me, you punk? And I don't like seeing cops that act like gang members either. And that's what we have a problem with, is men that didn't have fathers around who think acting like a thug and following what gangsters taught them is what's tough. That's not tough. That's not manly. That's cowardly. That's weak. That's pathetic. A man will stand up to the three gang members, knowing full well you can get stabbed to death, and tell them, I'll stomp your brains in. And let me tell you, I've done it too. And I'm not up here talking about how tough I am either. There comes a point when you got to stand up against scum. There comes a point when it doesn't matter what happens, that you got to stand up or you're no longer a human. And we reached that point a long time ago. So I don't give a you know what about the New World Order or what they do to me or anybody else. I've put my whole thing on the line, my family, my treasure, my name, all of it on the line, 100%. And when they bury me 6 feet under, you can know for sure I'll never compromise. I'll never sell out. I'll never submit. I'll never back down, because it's not in me to do it. And the reason we're in the position we are today is because other people don't have that attitude. Anyways. Excuse me. The sheriff is either stupid or he is a globalist, federal, wannabe gangster. And he makes me want to throw up that he's so dishonorable. And I'm going to go to Spokane, and he needs to man up and talk to me. Instead of sitting there talking trash about his constituents, they need to vote this guy out. All right, I'm going to stop right there. Excuse me. I get mad sometimes, and I try not to. We're in an info war, ladies and gentlemen. I've only plugged once an hour. It's how we fund the operation. I want to hire more reporters. I want to be able to send reporters around the country. I want to be able to sustain what we're doing and grow to the next level. We have incredible products, from water filtration to the best nutraceuticals out there. Brain Force, Supermill Vitality's back in. InfoWarsLife.com. Help fund our operations so we can go up against these people at 110%. InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. 888-253-3139. InfoWars.com. Go there. Support us, and bare minimum, send out on your email, your Facebook or Twitter or your YouTube, InfoWars.com/show. Hammer that link to the enemy. Hammer all these good sheriffs, bad sheriffs, with the links, with the videos, and go, look at all the evil and the corruption. Quit convincing yourself to go along with the globalist takeover. It's meant to impoverish the country and shut everything down. Do you really want to be signed on to that? Most of these people aren't even bad. They're cowards, so they lie to themselves. That's why they hate us so much, because we're so right and we hurt their conscience. It is not my intention to have a show that sounds like a WWF wrestling match, but all that just mimics what guys act like when they really get mad. It's just, I'm so tired of seeing the corruption and us being run over by tyranny. And I think about all the thugs and the liars and the scum, and it makes me really, really angry. We'll do a little bit of overdrive to finish up with these calls. There's a few other news items I need to hit. Some good news. Time Magazine and others are reporting, so is the LA Times, that fish oil helps minimize disorders for those at risk of schizophrenia, study finds. Yeah, so many neurological disorders are physical, not genetic or, quote, mental. Like toxicity in the body, heavy metal poisoning. If you're, say, 20 years old, and you go in and you're seeing little green men, they'll tell you you're schizophrenic and put you on medication. They won't test your blood for metal toxicity. I mean, they knew 30 years ago that if you take fish oil, it massively decreases epilepsy. And so there, another study about how great fish oil is, and it goes over it all. The omega-3 fatty acids, so important in supplements, new research found. But even people predisposed for schizophrenia, where it runs in family, who took the supplement had massive positive effects. I mean, I know that I can be angry and upset at like 7, 8 at night when I got to keep working. And it was my dad a decade ago said, son, fish oil. And I could take like 4 or 5 fish oil and I get like high off of it like I had 2 beers. I mean, it really works. What do you think Brain Force does? What do you think Super Male Vitality does? What do you think all these products are real? It's natural compounds, not drugs. I need to probably take some fish oil. In fact, my longevity fish oil from Forest Health is back there in the cabinet. Somebody bring me some EFAs. Because it will, it does act as a sedative as well. And I apologize for getting mad earlier. Believe me, it's not an act. I get exhausted after I do it, and I shouldn't do it. It's just this latest article with this stupid sheriffs. I don't want to be this guy's enemy. I know we're right. We just don't want to destroy the country and bring in basically corporate fascism. And so we're bad for no reason? You have made yourself bad by doing that. I want to go to something positive, too. This is these two sisters stumping for Trump. Story's up on Infowars.com, and Drudge has it. They're back. Donald gives hope to black lives. And whether Donald's good or not, at least it's getting past black-white. At least they're getting into an Americana idea of free market. Here it is.
Hey, y'all.
Hey.
So I'm here just talking to my African-American brothers and sisters.
Yes.
Now, listen, I see your frustration.
Yeah.
And I can feel your pain.
Yeah.
But we can no longer take and parade the narrative Black Lives Matter.
That's right.
In front of people when we don't feel like our own lives matter. When we take and we burn down our neighborhood.
Yes.
When we take and we kill our brothers and sisters.
Yes.
When we rob from them.
Yes.
When we do destructive things, what we're telling people is we don't care about our own lives.
Yep.
And sometimes that's why people can't care about us.
That's right.
Now, what I want you all to do is to take that energy and channel it behind someone that I know that care about all lives.
Yes.
And that's Mr. Donald Trump.
That's right.
Look, he is working to bring jobs back to this country.
That's right.
As a matter of fact, you have jobs. Keeping their jobs over here. Companies keeping their jobs over here for people like us so that you can become employed.
Yes.
And not only would you just be surviving in this country, but you should also be thriving in this country.
Right.
So I'm appealing to you to get behind the candidate, Mr. Donald Trump, that's going to do something for you.
Yes.
That's going to give you a hand up instead of a handout, baby.
That's right.
Now, my brothers in the streets, I understand your frustration, but it's time for you to get back to
all
work,
right,
baby.
That's right.
Full video on Infowars.com. And the point is, it's breaking the Democrat monopoly over black folks. We'll be back in Overdrive, Infowars.com/channel. We'll be back this Sunday, 4 to 6 p.m. This is